I had so many ideas to add to my journal, but would forget by the time I got home. Then I found Zinnia, the app that easily helps me record special moments and ideas, track my goals, schedule self-care moments, and document things that matter most. Zinnia makes creating content and ideas across screens so easy. Zinnia has so many cute journal templates, habit trackers, to-do lists, weekly logs, and more. I use my iPhone on the go and then switch to my iPad to edit, add photos, and draw. Then I can add directly to my socials. Download Zinnia on the App Store today.
Nerds. Today's episode is sponsored by NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast. Ready to expand your financial game? NerdWallet can coach you on smart strategies like choosing investments, finding your next credit card, and setting a budget that works for you. Score major points towards your summer vacation by learning expert tips for choosing a high-yield savings account and how to build wealth by investing in index funds. Slide into summer with smarter decisions in 2024. Follow NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast on your favorite podcast app. Future you will thank you.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
Yeah, I got an Ecobee smart home, and nosy Ned next door comes over to see. I told him about Ecobee. Turns out Ecobee's a lot smarter than his better-known smart home. I told him, Ned, get yourself a smarter home. Visit ecobee.com today.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
Unfortunately, what you're about to hear is real. The members of this radio program are simply not that bright, or what some people would call educated. They are merely stupid. They're not trying to offend anyone on purpose. And all have played doctors on TV. You have been warned and are cordially invited to join the party. This is the Men's Room.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown. Get with the countdown. Shake this square world and blast off for Kicksville. Kicksville. The trippers, the grasshoppers, the hip ones, all gathered in secrecy and flying high as a kite.
This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. You know what they say, shake your radio more than three times, and you're playing with it. You're listening to the Men's Room.
And away we go. Welcome to season 19, episode number 4,110. Along with Steve the Thrill Hill, the Ted Smith, and my car. Montgomery! And you are in the Men's Room. On tap today, we celebrate Armed Forces Day on a Bad Choice Friday. The return of Ted versus the FCC. Plus headlines, a Men's Room shot of the day, fundable listener emails, and everyone's favorite, TV time with Ted.
Clack, clack.
Drinking and drunk.
All right, here we go. A West Virginia politician is having a hard time proving that politicians aren't snakes.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, a man breaks into a police impound lot and guns and drugs he takes. Pro golfer makes his tee time after being released from jail at one New Hampshire daycare. Man, those kids sleep well. And a man breaks a world record for the longest streak of not getting leg goad. That is all coming on today's very special episode of The Men's Room.
And now, here's the question.
Hola, bitches. Good day to you and yours. All right, I'm a smoker and a parent, but I never smoke in the car, especially if my kids are in it. Now, here in Washington State, perfectly legal to do so. I just choose not to because it just feels icky, not to use such a big word right there. Now, growing up, my father, he was a smoker, and like most of my friends' parents, openly smoked in the car with us kids in it, and I didn't care until wintertime, because my father would crack the window, I'd sat in the seat behind him, and frankly, it was really freaking cold. By the way, smoking in cars with children is only illegal in 11 states. Now, on the other hand, 11, yes, 39, absolutely, if that's what you want to do. Now, on the other hand, I did love being in the car Well, my father would put me on his lap and let me steer while he did the pedals. Now, I don't know if it was legal then. It's definitely not legal now. But a man in New York, he discovered this recently when he let an 8-year-old steer the car. The car crashed into a tree, and the kid suffered multiple injuries. The man was arrested. Meanwhile, in Michigan, a man is facing charges after he drove a pickup with 5 children in the bed. Now, it didn't help that he, like the 8-year-old in New York, also crashed into a tree. One of the kids catapulted out, but it didn't suffer any serious injuries. But I remember as a kid begging to ride in the bed of a pickup truck. Yeah. And if we were good, then they would let us. But that was then, this is now. And some things from then, well, they're illegal now. Or it's just frowned upon. Hell, almost every single kid I know was a latchkey kid. It's only about 15% of kids now. It used to be 40% just a generation ago. And every kid I knew got spanked, both at home and school. It just had to be a day that ended with the letter Y. Now, that's not the case anymore. Hell, an employee at a school in New York, they just lost their job for that rare reason. Lined up the kids, smacked their ass with the ruler, they're out. But look, there's a lot of things that parents used to do back in the day. Not because they were bad parents. It was just different times, man. It's just that easy. Maybe they duct taped your feet to the bike pedals to teach you how to ride the bike. We actually have a little story about that one coming up. But today, we want you to go back in your way back machine and think about what things were like when you were growing up versus what you could probably get away with now. And that's what our question is. Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today?
Be part of the big show. Call 206-803-ROCK. Like the Men's Room on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Men's Room Live. And send your emails to the Men's Room at KISW.com.
Today's episode is sponsored by NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast. Get your head in the financial game with smart investing and budgeting tips straight from the nerds. NerdWallet's experts will set future you up for success with dependable, fact-based insights. No financial misinformation allowed. Learn how to save on your summer vacation, find your next credit card or loan for a big purchase, and invest in your next index fund. Make smarter decisions in 2024. Follow NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast on your favorite podcast app.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
Tired of fine lines and wrinkles? Dermaclara has the solution. Our 100% medical-grade silicone patches are designed to naturally reduce wrinkles and improve skin texture. Safe, effective, and reusable, these patches deliver visible results in as little as 20 minutes and lasting results in just 30 days. Our customers rave about their transformations. Plus, with our satisfaction guarantee, you can try Dermacare risk-free. Discover the power of natural skincare at Dermaclara.com and say hello to youthful, radiant skin.
We've covered everything from office staff, respect with patients, peers. So Dr. Buchanan, you can start by sharing 3 takeaways maybe that we can do to foster a more respectful workplace from your perspective.
So the number one thing I think is...
Dental sound bites created for dentists by dentists.
I would be shocked and appalled if someone said that to me in front of my staff.
I had no idea what to do.
Dental sound bites.
Listen now wherever you get your podcasts.
Debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
Oh, but Charles, away we go. Welcome to season 19, episode number 4110. What a large and in charge program we have for you today. On this oh-so-positive Friday, the exciting return of Ted versus the FCC. Round 3 on the cat who has gum and she guzzles it.
Oh, right. Yes.
Yes. So far, 0-2 on this one. We determined that we would give Ted 3 attempts to get this one right in Ted versus the FCC, which was nice because we knew that was coming. So last night, we didn't have to stay up way too late for Ted versus the FCC.
And once again, I played acoustic guitar for the orphan puppies.
Yeah,
they love it. Yeah.
Raised some money for charities. But Ted versus the FCC coming up. What else do we have for you today? Updated locations on the Men's Room IPA from Black Raven Brewing. We will give you those. Thanks for continuing to send those in when you find the beer. Bought a 6-pack for us for this afternoon.
Appreciate it.
So we are good to go on this positive Friday. I got that at the Shell Station again in between Ballard and Fremont. I like to call that Free Lard on Leary Way. So the Shell station there definitely has it. I got a six-pack for us today. Continue, please, and send us those pictures and locations, and we'll spread the word. What else? Metallica tickets. We have those for you every day in May. Your chance to win. We determine the time today will be 4:20.
Oh, it's a good time.
And when you hear that secret code word, you text that into 206-803-ROCK for your chance to win tickets to see Metallica every day in May. By the way, Kevin's got more of those tickets coming up for you later on tonight. Wait, there's more. A brand new Happy Hour is out. Episode number 10 exclusively on Odyssey and the Odyssey app. If you happen to search for the Men's Room, you'll see the Daily Men's Room podcast. Subscribe to that, and it'll appear on Friday morning, the Men's Room Happy Hour, a special little weekly podcast we're doing exclusively on the Odyssey app. But wait, there's so much more.
Oh, my God.
Yes. We will drink and toast in the weekend with a shot of the day that it's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
Hey, man, this is your fault.
Shame on. And tomorrow is Armed Forces Day, which is the kickoff to Armed Forces Week. It pays tribute to the military personnel serving in the United States Armed Forces. The United States military composed of how many branches, Ted?
There was five. I guess there's six now.
That is correct.
Because of Space Force.
Yes. Army, Air Force, Space Force, Navy, the Marine Corps, and the Coast Guard.
But I believe the Coast Guard is what, considered a branch of the military at the time of war or something like that?
They're,
I think it's just a branch of the military now.
More than 1.3 million active duty service members.
What about the Salvation Army?
In the United States and around the world.
Those bells don't ring themselves.
Yes. An additional 800,000 reservists.
What about the KISS Army?
Stand ready in the Army National Guard and the Air National Guard. The holiday unites the country behind the men and women who currently serve in the United States military.
All right.
So just keep that in mind. Tomorrow is Armed Forces Day. So why not salute them with the village people?
You can find someone to squeeze. You can drop down on your knees.
Yeah. Village people, and in the Navy, who could they take on? You know them as the Gap Band.
You touch the bomb on me, baby. You touch the bomb on me. You touch the bomb on me.
I feel like this is the anthem of a public toilet.
The Gap Band, and you dropped a bomb on me, taking on the village people in the Navy. Those are your choices on a Bad Choice Friday. Vote now if you follow us on Twitter at Men's Room Live. We'll play one of those two tunes coming up right after we drink and toast with a shot of the day. And today we're going to go back in time. As you know, when you're growing up, you know only what you know. As far as whatever world your parents bring you up in, that is the world you know. Where they have their home, where they live, where your parents have jobs. It's kind of out of your control. But the good news is, as a child, you don't know any different than what you know.
Right. You don't know what you don't know.
It doesn't matter where you grew up. All the rules with parents are a little bit different from place to place.
Sure.
And there are certain things now that we could look at as far as how society views things and say, hey, since that point in time when I was a kid, things have changed, so to speak, as far as what is understood to be acceptable parenting and some things that might have been questionable back in the day.
Sure, but back in the day, pretty much everything was acceptable parenting. You know, whether they'd send you as a kid to buy them smokes, buy them beer, you didn't give it another thought. You knew it was adult stuff. It's not like you did it, but you went to the store to buy it. They would be so angry at you. If you said, like, my kid always wants to stop at the gas station, like, get a candy bar and a Fanta, right? Like, cool. And I'll send him in there to buy that stuff, and he can buy it himself, and he walks out. But if I know I need a pack of Marlboro Reds, I groan because I'm like, all right, I'm going to go in with you. And he'll even ask, like, Dad, I could get that. I'm like, no, you can't. He goes, why? I think you got to be a certain age. And he goes, do they think I'm going to smoke them? I said, no, they don't think you're going to smoke them, but the law is that you can't buy them. And then I'll tell him, you know, Pop, I used to buy his smokes, and it blows his mind.
Well, also, you got to remember, growing up at our age, 12 years old, 13 years old, there were kids who were sneaking cigarettes.
They were smoking weed, yeah.
I don't see that as much today just based on the fact that over time, again, kids know one thing for sure. Cigarettes are going to kill you. So most of them are not really interested in rebellion-wise doing that. Yeah, they might have a hit off a joint. you know, at a younger age, more so than they should. But I don't think cigarettes is where they're going. Chewing tobacco is not where they're going.
But most people don't smoke now. So if your kid smoked a cigarette now, you know as soon as you smell. But when we were in the 70s, everybody smoked. I mean, you could
inside your home.
That's what I mean. So you didn't notice anyone that smelled like smoke because everyone's home smelled like smoke. People smell like smoke. The inside of the car smelled like smoke. So if you snuck a cigarette as a kid, it was camo, man.
Right.
There's no way to identify that your kid was smoking if you did not bust them red-handed because the house was full of smoke. Your white walls were yellow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it was everyone had an ashtray. Everyone.
Wallpapers peeling.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you're right, there's so much less smoking. You can tell when somebody smokes. Even just in a bar. It's not a bad thing. You're just like, oh, they smoked a cig.
Well, it's the thing. I mean, you can't smoke indoors anywhere except your own home if you so choose. And even though I own my home, I still go outside to smoke. I've never lit a cigarette in my home in the 10 years that I've lived in the house.
No. Well, even without kids, I doubt you'd probably sit in your house and rip cigs.
Right, even before kids. Right, same
thing. I mean, Miles, you live alone. You don't smoke inside your home.
Oh, God, no.
But 20 years ago, I did, though.
We were still
in Baltimore. I still smoked in my house. It was 20 years
ago. Me too.
Ago.
Yeah.
All right.
But
me
you
too.
Could still smoke in bars. So the idea of smoking outside, unless you wanted to have a private conversation with someone, you know, you sat at the bar, they handed you an ashtray, you lit a cigarette, you smoked it, right? Whether you were a smoker or not, you reeked the smoke. So when you got home, smoking inside was not weird to me.
And do we not smoke outside of the CVP every once in a while? Or am I just remembering?
We would smoke weed out there. Smoke a cigarette because we're also smoking weed.
Well, there was a cigarette machine when you walked in.
Yeah, but we didn't go outside just to smoke a cigarette. We were lighting a joint.
I can't remember it.
Yeah, we smoked inside.
So we went outside to smoke weed.
Then we would smoke a cigarette while smoking weed, yes.
Definitely smoking outside, I guess.
It was marijuana.
That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, you could still smoke cigarettes in there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't smoke in my car. Even when I take road trips down to Oregon and it's 4 or 5 hour drive, I will pull off at a rest area, use the bathroom, smoke a cigarette there. My previous car, I'd smoked in it.
Sure.
I didn't care.
But it's built into my head now. I don't think about it.
I just don't want my car to smell for any reason I needed to sell the damn thing. I just want to keep it clean.
Yep.
You know, all those things.
You know what? The last car I smoked in was a rental car. My wife just points where it says no smoking. I'm like, yeah, I don't care. I mean, you know, like, sorry, man. Like,
your name's on it.
The kids aren't in the car. We're on a long-ass trip, right? We're stuck in this car forever. Do you want to pull over, like, every 20 minutes when I'm going to nick fit? Or I'll just crack the window. She's like, look, I don't care other than I don't want the car to smoke. I said, I don't either. But I said, worst-case scenario, I'll pay the fine. I said, look, that's the worst.
Yep.
I'm not going to get arrested. I'm not going to go to jail. They don't beat you. I'm like, look, and you know what? We brought the car back. I'm waiting for the guy to say it smells like smoke. Nothing.
Good.
Cool.
There was a story earlier this week. We all know who Paris Hilton is, and she has, I believe, two babies now? One baby, two babies?
Does she carry any of them in her body?
Just one.
Maybe she has just one. Okay, I don't think that she carried the child.
Right.
Either way, son or daughter, I think it's a son. I don't follow her on social media. I'm not sure.
What?
I'm not sure where she put this up. Maybe Instagram or Facebook. But either way, she showed a video of her kid in the back of her car. Now, this car was a substantial SUV type thing, but the kid is under 1 year old, obviously, and the car seat was facing forward.
Mm-hmm.
Now, traditionally, at that age, the car seat faces the back of the vehicle. As far as, you know, if you get into a crash, your child's head's not going to whip forward. So, obviously, people who saw this post, they reached out and said, Paris, you've got the seat backwards, so you need to turn the seat around for the safety of your child. And to her credit, she was very gracious and grateful, and she replied, thank you, I was not aware.
Yeah, you're trying to do the best for your kid.
Yeah, I will take care of that immediately, and I'll turn the seat around.
But I did not know that either when we first had a kid, you know what I mean? And so when we had our daughter, that's my oldest, you could not leave the hospital until the car seat was installed in your car properly, right? No big deal. And I appreciate them doing that, but we bought the car seat, put it in, and it's weird. Like, the first one's how you have to get all the straps through. It should not be as complicated as it is, but for whatever reason, it just...
And you got to get it in tight, the base.
Super tight. So, and I thought we're all set, we're ready to go, and they have a nurse come down with you, and she checks the car. And the first thing she says is, it's facing the wrong way. And I said, what are you talking about, man? She goes, it's got to face backwards. I truly...
You didn't know that.
Did not know, because when you look at a car, everyone faces forward, you just assume, right? So she goes, man, got to face backwards. I'm like, okay. And then she kind of jiggles it. And she's like, it's loose. I'm like, that's as tight as I could get it. I don't know what she did, man, but I mean, that's
really... ratcheted it.
Yeah.
She ratcheted it.
But she flipped it around, but that's when I found out. But I'm also the same guy that my wife's like, 9 months pregnant. I mean, this baby probably had a foot hanging out at this point, but we're at Babies R Us or some crap. And she's buying all these other things, as I perceive it. And I'm standing in front of the baby food. And I'm like, why don't we buy some freaking food for our kid, too? You know, they got to eat.
She's they get hungry.
She's like, yeah. She's like, we're not buying that.
5 or 6 months.
And I said, well, what's wrong with this stuff? So I'm like, it's freaking baby food. That's what they got, that ugly-ass little baby. You know, it's Gerber. Like, what? She's like, you're going to kill our kid. I'm like, what are you talking about? I did not know. Keep in mind, I am like 2 seconds away from being a dad. You don't give infants baby food.
No, you don't.
Now, look, I know that now, so it's all just background information. But you don't know what you don't know. And I'm like, what? And she's like, okay, first of all, it's an infant. It's not a baby yet. So infant food is basically anything liquid. I honestly didn't know.
I can tell you this. I am, as far as stuff, I don't really always look at the directions or said follow directions.
Yeah, you're a dude. That's what we do.
But when it came to putting in a car seat and when it came to putting a crib together, I was meticulous about following the step-by-step instructions.
Absolutely.
Because I was terrified that if I did anything wrong,
you're going to kill your kid.
Then something bad could possibly happen. Well, so, I mean, I was just laser-focused on. I wasn't even stoned when I put that crib together. And typically, if I'm doing a project like putting IKEA furniture together or a barbecue grill or whatever it is, it's got tons of bolts and parts and things and instructions. I did take my time with my barbecue grill. But everything else, you know,
I took my time at the crib, but the question that kept bugging me, right? And I kept saying, and we were both there, and like you said, you are more meticulous about putting together a crib than anything else we've ever put together, right? But I kept looking at my wife, and I said, I don't know the answer to this question, and I'm not trying to be an alarmist, but, you know, there's always these crib recalls, because something goes wrong, kids suffocate or whatever, and I go, is it because of the crib design? Because that's one thing. Or the fact that we, as parents, are putting this together. And I couldn't get that out of my head. It was freaking me out. I'm like, because I'm looking at the script, it doesn't look like there's anything wrong with it. I put it together, but if something goes wrong, is this my fault or the crib? Because if you say it's the crib design, I go, okay, don't buy that crib. But I'm putting this together, and I know how people put things together, myself included. But it's a way. If it's not my father putting something together, I don't necessarily trust it. And I'm like, if this kid dies, man, this is on me. And I mean, it freaked me out.
All right.
Like
so my crib was a hand-me-down that someone had given to my mother.
All right.
Now, as far as cribs go,
the crib you were in as a baby.
My crib is a baby. Okay. Now, as far as cribs go, each side or one side has a pull-down side, typically where you can lower the side and reach in and grab your infant if you need to. Well, the one that I had, the one side where the railing was halfway down. Okay, now, as a baby, that was just fine. It did not matter that one side was down halfway. But as I grew older...
And could move?
And could pull myself up and stand up and jump up and down on the bed. Now the railing is at about, my mom said, about, you know, a little bit over my waist.
Huh? Yeah.
Well, she told me that she would hear, thump, and then she would have to walk into my room and pick me off the floor and put me back. And she said it was constant. Anytime, every time she put me to bed, you hear, thump. And I just hit the deck because I didn't want to go to bed, I guess.
Yeah, that's typical
kids. She just came back in. It was a hardwood floor. Came back in, picked me up. She didn't put a rug down or anything. She knew I was bailing out every time. I mean, I must have. She said it was almost nightly that I would hit the deck on the floor, or when I woke up in the middle of the night, or when I woke up in the morning before her, or whatever the deal was. I tried to, if I could hear them, she said, I tried to get out of the crib. And because the railing was so low, I would never, if my kid kept falling off.
I know.
They'd be taking care of it. You get a new crib immediately. Yeah. You know what I mean? But not my 22-year-old, 21-year-old mother at the time. Like, that's what I can do. That's what you've got. That's where you're sleeping.
So my dad had to, the reason he bought his first power tool, because of me. So in one night, according to them, I would jump up and down, but I rocketed out of the crib. Apparently landed on my head on a dresser. They take me to the emergency room. And my mom goes, the doctors already look a little suspect. So they think maybe we're beating you over there. Fine. Whatever. They get back home. Later that same night, I did it again. So they had to take me back to the hospital again. And at this point, they're threatening to call CPS. And my mom's like, you know, and we understood why, but they're like, listen, basically, as my father put it, the kid's an idiot. You know what I mean? Like, we're not doing anything to him. He is stupid. You would think he wouldn't do it again. So that night, they stopped at Sears. He bought a drill, took my crib apart, lowered the bed part almost down to the floor, put me back in. That way, the bars were now over my head, so I couldn't jump out. That's why he bought a drill.
Our question, back in the day, what did your parents do that would not fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors.
pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo spiked aguas frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo spiked aguas frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo spiked aguas frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Start your summer road trip at Midas and get up to $30 off your next repair service. Plus, get a free closer look vehicle check to make sure you're road trip ready. So if you need a brake service, an alignment check, or tune-up, hit up Midas for up to $30 off. For more details, request your appointment at Midas.com.
Are you a fan of mystery and adventure? Introducing June's Journey, the captivating free-to-play mobile game that will ignite your inner detective. Play as June Parker in a thrilling murder mystery adventure as you search for hidden objects to uncover the truth behind her sister's death. Step into the glamorous world of the Roaring Twenties with stunningly illustrated scenes and over 1,000 mysteries to unravel. With new chapters added weekly, you'll never run out of clues to chase and suspects to interrogate. Plus, you can build your own island escape with beautiful gardens and buildings and even join a detective club to collaborate with other players. Experience the thrill of being a detective and unravel the mystery in June's Journey. Download June's Journey now on your Android or iOS device or play on PC through Facebook Games.
Rev up your drive with Volkswagen of Bellingham's exclusive offer. For a limited time, get behind the wheel of a brand new 2024 Volkswagen Atlas, Taos, or Tiguan with 4.9% APR for 72 months. Head to Volkswagen of Bellingham today to drive home in style. This offer is only valid through March 4th. Terms and conditions apply. Visit VolkswagenofBellingham.com to learn more.
Miles and Thrill.
Portage, Michigan. A neighbor's ring cam captured the moment the driver of a pickup truck crashed into a tree. Five kids were riding in the bed of the truck while a 35-year-old Kalamazoo man drove around the Mallard Cove Apartments, according to Portage Public Safety. Our neighbors were yelling at the guy to slow down and wondered why he was going so fast. He was like, "Hey, I'm just having fun with the kids." And we're like, "Okay, well, our kids are out here and you're going to hit them." And he just sped off. Robert said she watched the crash from her window. He lost control of the vehicle over a speed bump because he was then in the grass and ran straight into a tree. In the video, you see the airbags inflate upon impact, and one of the kids is flipped out of the truck. Neighbors then rushed to the scene. When the public safety got there, Chief Nick Arnold said the kids were scattered on the ground. The driver was pinned inside. He had some pretty good damage to his face, but nothing life-threatening. Went around to try to help him because clearly he had some injuries. He was not in a state where we wanted to cooperate, or he did, so he was physically trying to get away. We had to detain him and get him into custody. When the driver got out of the truck, they said he didn't even stop to check on the kids.
Oh, come on, man.
He didn't get out until the police came, and he climbed through the window and fell on the ground, then tried to get away. He is awaiting arraignment. Police said they don't know the relationship between the driver and the kids in the truck, but the kids are all okay, which is the good news.
Well, you can legally have kids in the bed of the pickup truck, but I believe they have to be 16 or older.
Washington state regulators say it's generally prohibited for individuals under 16 years old to ride in the truck bed on public roads. Exceptions exist for specific situations, such as agricultural operations.
All right, so you're working on the farm. Cool.
Parades, emergencies. Children 13 and under should ride in the cab of a pickup truck. However, if there are children under the age of 18 years old, you have to drive less than 16 miles per hour, according to Washington state law.
16?
16 miles
an hour. I'm driving 15 miles an hour.
16 miles an hour.
I got a bunch of kids in the pickup. I could explain that away. Like, hey, man, we have not gone over 16
miles
an hour.
You're not on a public road.
Okay, but it can't be on a public road. Okay.
So, in other words, think farm. Think, again, parade. I mean, in these
driveway,
whatever the circumstances are.
We didn't drive, like, huge distances. But, like, if my dad he would always borrow, like, his buddy's truck around Christmas.
Yeah.
We would get blankets, and we would sit in the back and drive around the neighborhood and look at Christmas lights.
Yeah, it was awesome, man. Mm-hmm. When you're a kid, yeah. Please let us ride in the back.
Our question back in the day, what did your parents do that would not fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Zach. Welcome to the men's room.
Boo, bitches.
Boo.
So also, in theory, if your kid was bleeding out, you could just throw him in the back of the truck and drive down the highway. It's an emergency.
Yeah.
I mean, I think last time I rode in the back of a truck, somebody was giving me a ride home. So I just laid flat.
So no, So this is when you knew you weren't supposed to be back, that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. It was like midnight.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Well, I feel like if you were born 30 years ago or more, like, there wasn't a whole lot your parents couldn't get away with.
That is true.
Before my story, I grew up with a single dad. We lived in like a big open neighborhood, probably 2 miles of like paved roads and stuff. So when he would pick me up from school or whatever, we'd get home or get to the beginning of the neighborhood and he'd let me drive. I'd drive us all the way home and I learned to drive like 10 years old and it was a freaking clutch too. Anyway,
so you weren't sitting in his lap technically. You were actually operating the entire motor vehicle.
Yeah. And you're driving a stick.
Yeah.
Hey, good on you, man. I mean, I know not the way you're supposed to do it, but I mean, when I was growing up, man, depending where I lived, and Baltimore, not so much because it's the middle of the city, but when we're out in the cut in upstate New York, pretty much, like you said, the parents would get within a certain distance of the house and then switch with the kids and let the kid drive the car the rest of the way home. You know, that was the treat.
My buddy Chad, his grandmother had a farm. This is weird, West Virginia rule. But if you have a truck that's used on a farm, it does not need a license. It does not need to be registered as long as it says farm use on it. And they recommended, and I'm not making this up, that you spray that on the side of the car.
Like an orange or something.
Right,
so you can't
farm
miss it.
Use. Yeah. All right. So he learned to drive on the farm doing chores for his grandmother when he was 12 or 13 years old.
Yeah, I think that's a good thing.
Now, there was a store down the street that was probably no more than a half mile from where his grandmother's farm was, where you could get feed and, you know, pick up. It was a general store. There was nothing in there that you couldn't get. If you needed a can of gas, you could get it there.
Yeah.
If you needed a loaf of bread, they had that. They had everything at the store. And he would drive down to that store and pick up whatever he needed and drive back. And it was never a question. It was, you know, he was 12 or 13 years old. He knew how to drive the truck, and he would drive it on roads and go down. If he wanted to go get a pizza, he'd take a lunch break. He would go down to the pizza place and go get himself a pizza. Or what was the name of the fast food place? Moorfield. I can't remember. Maybe like a DQ Brazer or whatever the hell it was. Yeah, just go. And I'm like, you got to be kidding me. He told me this, you know, I was like, because I didn't meet him until I was 18 years old.
Oh, right.
I ended up going back to visit his hometown and his grandmother. But same truck, when we got there, hopped in. It was awesome because she had a ton of property, man.
And yeah.
Dirt roads. We could take it off and just tear it through the farm. And I don't know. We had a good time in it. But
I think it's great because in the end, you're making a judgment call on your kid, right? So my daughter, she'll be 14 later this year. In theory, she could drive in 2 years. And I'm telling you, no. Right? And you assess the child. My son, I'd be like, sure, you get your license at 12 for all I care, because he's just one of those guys.
What if she takes driver's ed and goes through the process when she's 15? And
I mean, I'm not
going
to forbid her from doing it, but like, look, you're not going to drive a vehicle that I own. You will have to get a job and buy your own car. That's all, because I already know how this is going to go. I mean, honestly, that would be it. I'll pay for half the car even, but it's going to be a beater. It might be old enough that it is still made of steel, you know, just because you know your kid. So if I lived on a farm right now, I still wouldn't have her drive. I wouldn't even have her drive the riding lawnmower out to the pasture. But my son would be like, absolutely.
I'm the opposite with my niece and nephew. I mean, they're both, you know, Maddie's 21, 22.
Sure.
Like, CJ's 20, so he's old. Like, when Maddie was 16, I had no issue driving with her.
Mm-hmm.
But if me and CJ got to run an errand, I'm like, I'm driving.
Right, exactly. Okay. And that's the thing. That's what I'm saying. So even, you know, if you have the farm and the kid's 12 and they're doing a motor vehicle, it's like, you're still making a judgment call on the kid. Like, I know they have child labor laws. My kid is 12. If they said, man, we'd love for him to work for us, it's like, he would be a great employee. Right. Legally, I can't do it. And again, my daughter would be like, depends what you're asking her to do. But yeah, my son, no question.
I made the same deal with my daughter. And I knew I felt more comfortable with my younger daughter driving than my older.
Sure.
My older daughter's kind of a do-do-do-do-do.
That's the way my daughter is, right? So it's kind of
all over the place.
You need to focus. That's the difference. You need to focus.
My younger daughter is a little bit more street smart, so to speak. Okay.
Yes.
So she wanted to get a car. And I'm like, all right, I will pay for half the car. You come up with your, and she worked. I was like, you come up with the money.
That's it. You said she hustled. She got it done.
She was a barista and all that stuff. And so she's like, I got $1,000. And I'm like, all right, well, I'll match whatever you save up. She's like, I think I can get this car because my mom's friend is getting rid of their older family car that they've had for a while. It was a 2006 Volvo something 60.
All right.
Whatever.
All right. C60.
Safe car. Yeah, something like that. It had over, you know, 150,000 miles on it and all that. But the more important part to me is those Volvos are built like tanks.
Exactly.
So I was more concerned about that. So for $2,000, And she was 16 years old. She had that car, and she drove it until she was 22 years old.
Damn, okay.
And it never really had any problems, just tire changes and brakes.
Right. Oil changes, normal
the
stuff.
Belts, the basic stuff. But I thought for sure that that car, she would wreck it.
Yeah, of course.
Something bad would happen, like, you know what I mean? It would blow a transmission or just something beyond the repair value of the actual value of the car.
Yeah.
None of that ever happened. I was really impressed with that damn car.
And your daughter driving it.
And she would drive it. Keep in mind, she would drive it from Seattle to San Diego and back. So if she was coming back for a winter holiday, which was like a month in college, mm-hmm. she would drive it from San Diego. So she had a car. She'd drive it back down. Took her 2 days to do it.
That's what I mean. You know the kid where you're like, okay, I trust
this. Well, that was also, I was like, make sure you have these things in your car. Make sure you have, like, I bought her an emergency road kit.
Mm-hmm.
So if the car broke down on the way.
You know, yeah, you had everything in
there. She could put a little triangle up or a flare or whatever the hell was in there.
Yeah.
Because I thought for sure in the middle of Oregon or some crap in the middle of nowhere, Northern California, her car broke down.
But again, I can buy that for both of my kids. I know one of them's going to use it, the other one will not, in spite of it being right there in the car.
Yeah. Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Alex. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola, bitches.
Hola.
Hello.
So, the thing that my parents did that most likely would not fly today was leaving home and playing outside without any parental supervision of any sort.
Yeah, man. That to me, that was the best part of childhood. It's basically summer break, and it's just the conversation your parents had with you. So you're out for school for the summer. You wake up, I don't know, maybe it's 10 o'clock in the afternoon. I had until about noon to be out of the house because my mother would see me and literally ask the question, why are you in my home? Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. And so, but she never said, it was just go, like just leave, go do something that does not involve me. So it's not like we got into a lot of trouble, but still, you were gone basically until sundown. This is pre-cell phone, so they're not checking on your ass every 15 seconds. They rarely even called a friend's house to see where you were. You would just come home, and you were dirtier. There's usually a little bit of dried blood, a few dried tears.
Yeah.
But they didn't. They never asked, like, what happened. It's just kids being kids. Mm-hmm. And you're right, man.
Can I say something here real quick?
What's that?
Because my parents actually grew up in that era, they are still a little bit old-fashioned. So when I was growing up, I'm 24 now, but they kind of passed that way of parenting along to me. So back in the early 2000s, they were basically the same way. They were like, get your ass outside. We don't want to see you in here until like, say, dinner time or something.
Yeah.
Go outside.
Yeah,
that's exactly right.
Yeah.
I try to do that with my kids as much as I can. It's kind of tough, but it's just I have the same conversation with my kids each time. They'll have a bunch of buddies over, and if it's nice out, like, you guys got to play outside in here. Don't do anything effing stupid. That is an actual quote I say, and they understand my point, and there's no problem. I don't care what you guys do. I don't even care if you're up to no good. Don't get caught, and you won't get caught if you don't do anything effing stupid.
Alex, you're down in San Jose, right? Alex in San Jose?
I am, yes.
Yeah, you went to Pearl Jam the other night, right?
I did, yes, in Sacramento.
How was the show?
Of the four shows now I've been to, I think this is by far my least favorite.
Why?
And my favorite being the first one I went to at the time as it was known then, Safeco Field.
Well, okay, wow, that's a home show. It's going to be a
little
bit
What made
better.
This one, why was this your least favorite? What was the difference between the other three shows?
I would have to say the set list. It was not a bad show by any stretch of the imagination. It was a fantastic show. It's just that
not the tunes you wanted to hear.
I think it might have to do with the fact with them playing a lot of new songs. I mean, I haven't listened to their new album yet through its entirety, so I get that might have something to do with it.
Oh, it does. Right, okay. I mean, look, any
and
band
they're pretty famous for switching up.
They switch it up every night.
They are notorious for doing that, but it is a tough sell for a band to play stuff off the new, other than whatever your big hit is. Like,
they'll play Dark Matter.
They've got a new one for you.
I mean, I've seen them on the same tour where one show was a lot more low key and kind of some of their slower stuff.
Yeah,
and then a few weeks later, it was like
completely
all the hits.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, the other ones were, it's Pearl Jam. They're all hits.
By the way,
just a little more upbeat.
Did you know that the Daily Migs morning show has your chance to win tickets 1 week from today?
Where at?
They're doing their show live. I'm glad you asked at the Aurora Borealis and Shoreline.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah. You can stop by in your pajamas. It's called Pearl Jam's Pajama Jam, you see.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to swing by there.
Last chance to pick those up. And I believe they serve breakfast there and they have beers and all that stuff.
They do. They have good food.
If you're looking for a chance to pick up tickets to see Pearl Jam here in Seattle, again, that is next Friday. 1 week from today at Aurora Borealis and Shoreline. So Daily Mix Show will be doing a live one from there.
Yeah, I'm going to swing by. I can't win the tickets, but I'm going to swing by anyway.
A question back of the day. What did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Not with that attitude.
No. Yeah. Oh, it's not that you work here. You're a bit of an a-hole, Thrill.
Right.
Hello, Andrew. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
My voice has been like this a long time, Thrill. You dissed it before. Okay?
Oh, we're still going to diss it today.
And that's Miles giving you crap.
That's consistency, bro. It's consistency.
Miles defended me.
Yeah, we smoke it. It'll sound like you.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. How about whip ya?
What's that now?
Whip.
The parents? Yeah, beating your ass with the belt?
Yeah.
Yeah, we were bad. My brother and I purposefully. One time we burned our mother's razor strap, and we were very poor. She went out and got a 3-foot section of the garden hose. We never got whipped with a razor strap again.
Yeah, I bet
you. She said, I can get these all day long. Yeah, my brother and I were bad by design, and we had great parents.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, those are the days, man. Yeah. Capital with punishment. That is exactly what was doled at. My thing was, like, you might get your ass slapped, right? Rarely did I get, quote-unquote, a spanking. You got your ass slapped. You knew it was coming. When the belt came out, right, you have basically, it's the equivalent, you have murdered someone, right? This is the punishment coming your way. And you could take it. The problem was, because my mother would always say, you know, get your father to do it. And I preferred my father for one reason. Now, he did it harder. But my father has much better aim. So he at least hit my ass, right? The fleshiest part. My mom would try, and you can't really tell her, like, hey, can you do it a little higher? You know what I mean? It's not a massage, but...
Well, she's kind of short.
She would hit... Well, she hit your ass. If you got three of these belt hits, two hit your ass, one hit the back of your thighs, and that's the one... And she wasn't trying to, man. And she would even apologize, because, give me a fucking hell. I'm so angry at you. Could you take that? Oh, my God, I'm so sorry. It's like, just hit my ass.
The one that sucked the most for me was a teacher who had a big ass, like a Super Bowl ring, man. I mean, this dude was like, you know, big, fat-fingered, gold-wearing...
Big old meat paws on
him. Yeah, I mean, he's always smelling like cologne. You know the guy with his shirt buttoned down a little bit, right? But he was a teacher, and he would come, and he would flap you on the back, on the top of the head, backhand you with that ring, and I mean, oh, God.
Yeah.
That was bad.
We got our class rings. I feel like we did that for a week straight to each other.
It
hurts.
Because everybody wore them that week to school, and we would just spin them around and pop each other. Bam.
Yeah. And my grandmother, my stepfather's mother, she was basically the only parent in the home with three kids because her husband, their dad, traveled constantly. He was, you know, military. He's one of those guys who was commissioned, and when he was commissioned to go someplace, he basically would work on a project for 2 to 3 months at a time wherever he needed to go as an engineer.
Yeah.
And take care of the problem. Then he would move on. That's kind of what he did. So he was very rarely home, but every time he was home, he just wanted to be around his kids, hugged them, loved them. And then you've got grandma, the mom, who has to be the disciplinarian. And she would make them go out, take switches from the trees, clean them all off. She'd beat them with switches. They're bad. Two girls and a boy. Didn't matter. She would take wooden spoons because she was always in the kitchen. She was always fixing
wooden meals. Spoon was the one, man.
And a wooden spoon to the top of the head. Wooden spoon. You know, you name it, man. They just took off running. You know, like she just picked that thing up, man, and they just scatter.
Because you know it's coming.
Yeah, and she was never real. And that was the weird thing about Grandma Mary. She was never very affectionate because she had to draw that line of being a disciplinarian where, you know, my grandfather, their father, was just the sweetest man. He was the guy who gave you the hugs, slipped you a $5 bill to, you know, go get some ice cream, whatever. You know, you're always hoping that he was here because he would be the defender just in case, you know, so kind of calm her down.
Yeah, we always had three strikes with the belt from Dad. It was kind of the common punishment, as it were, and he would make a production out of it. Just
of course.
You know, get his point across. I mean, to this day, even when I'm taking my own belt out of my belt loops, like I get some flashbacks from time to time. I'm like, oh damn. But there was one time I got in trouble.
Snap.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That it just running through every single belt loop is just that still triggers me in the back. But there was one time because my dad never wanted to be the you wait till your father gets home situation, right? Because he had that back when he was a kid. He didn't want his kids fearing him when he came home. So that was kind of the rule with mom as well. It's like, if you need to, you take care of business. So there was one time where it was only mom that was there and she had to take care of business. And my mom is not a very, was not a very strong woman. She was a very gentle woman. However, she needed to spank me at this one point. I cried. I tried my hardest for her because I did not want her to tell my dad the point in the cross.
Back in the day, what did your parents do that would not fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Start your summer road trip at Midas and get up to $30 off your next repair service. Plus, get a free closer look vehicle check to make sure you're road trip ready. So if you need a brake service, an alignment check, or tune-up, hit up Midas for up to $30 off. For more details, request your appointment at Midas.com.
Struggling with fine lines and wrinkles? Let me tell you about Dermaclara. Our 100% medical-grade silicone patches have changed the game for so many people. Safe, natural, and incredibly effective, these patches deliver visible improvements in just 30 days. Jessica from New York said her fine lines started to fade after just a week of using Dermaclara, and within a month, her skin was smoother and more radiant than ever. Megan from California couldn't believe how quickly her stretch marks disappeared. It takes as little as 20 minutes per use to start seeing results because Dermaclara's reusable occlusion patches work by enhancing your skin's natural healing process. Your skin gets the best care possible for every stage of your skincare journey with just one ingredient, medical-grade silicone. And we prioritize safety without compromising results at Dermaclara. And we stand by our products with a satisfaction guarantee, so there's no risk in trying Dermaclara. Visit Dermaclara.com today and say goodbye to wrinkles and hello to beautiful, radiant skin.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Planet Oat oat milk is so rich and creamy.
I love it in my cereal, but also in smoothies.
With 0 grams of sugar in Planet Oat unsweetened varieties. But it gets even better. It's an excellent source of calcium with vitamins A and D that's delicious in everything. Mmm, including my lattes. Pick up the carton that has it all. Or visit planetoat.com for more. Planet Oat. Be good to you.
I had so many ideas to add to my journal, but would forget by the time I got home. Then I found Zinnia, the app that easily helps me record special moments and ideas, track my goals, schedule self-care moments, and document things that matter most. Zinnia makes creating content and ideas across screens so easy. Zinnia has so many cute journal templates, habit trackers, to-do lists, weekly logs, and more. I use my iPhone on the go and then switch to my iPad to edit, add photos, and draw. Then I can add directly to my socials. Download Zinnia on the App Store today.
Start your summer road trip at Midas and get up to $30 off your next repair service. Plus, get a free closer look vehicle check to make sure you're road trip ready. So if you need a brake service, an alignment check, or tune-up, hit up Midas for up to $30 off. For more details, request your appointment at Midas.com.
Welcome to Nada Yada Island.
This season on Nada Yada Island.
When we were new, they spoiled me. They even gave me a phone. But then, it's like I didn't exist.
Don't take yada yada from your wireless carrier. Now with Metro, get that new customer feeling again and again. Introducing Metro Flex. Free 5G phones when you join, same deals as new customers when you stay. Only at Metro by T-Mobile.
Just bring your number and ID and sign up for an eligible plan. After 12 months, trade in and get our best deals on select devices.
Three reasons why your kiddo will love Kate Farms Kids Nutrition Shakes. For starters, each nutrient-dense kids shake is made with love for your child's growth and development. Each carton contains 8 grams of plant-based protein plus 27 vitamins and minerals. Secondly, with 3 tasty flavors to choose from in strawberry, chocolate, or vanilla, even the pickiest eaters approve. Lastly, each Kate Farms Kids Shake comes ready to drink with a resealable twist-off cap, great for the car or their lunchbox. Give your kids the quality nutrition they deserve. Get 25% off your first purchase with code AUDIO. Exclusions may apply. See katefarms.com for details.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith from The Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Coming up, we'll drink a toast in the weekend with a shot of the day that it's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
It's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
Hey, man, this is your fault.
Come on. And we salute to Armed Forces Day on a Bad Choice Friday. Armed Forces Day is tomorrow, so why not a little Village People? I wonder if Navy recruitment went up during the heyday of that song.
I don't know that it did, man. They seem to sell different image of the Navy than I think anyone thought realistically.
Top Gun brought people into the military. How about the Village People?
Because Top Gun looked cool.
Correct. You're saying the Village People didn't look cool.
When I was a kid, I thought they were super cool, but I still somehow thought, if I joined the Navy, I don't think I'm going to be as pumped up as they are. You know?
Village People in the Navy taking on the Gap Band.
You dropped the bomb on me, baby. You dropped the bomb on me. You dropped the bomb on me.
Vote now on a Bad Choice Friday. If you follow us on Twitter, a Men's Room Live will be the Gap Band. And you dropped a bomb on me or Village People in the Navy. Vote now, one of those two tunes coming up right after we drink and toast with a shot of the day.
Gap Band sounds like every high school, middle school, wedding I've ever been to on the East Coast of my life.
It absolutely does.
They're playing this song.
Boom. Back in the day, what did your parents do that would not fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Couple of texts here. Says, my mom would send me to buy cigarettes when I was 8, but I had a note. She also had a wooden wooden hand that said, Mom's helping hand to spank us with. That from Rebecca Lee. Hmm. I grew up in a smoking household. I never realized how much it stunk until I moved out of the house. I was so embarrassed that I smelled like that when I go to friends' houses or they came to mine. Most of the houses I went through, someone in the house smoked, so you couldn't tell.
I went to grade school with one guy, and he absolutely hated it.
Cigarette smoke?
Because his parents smoked inside. So I guess even back then, some of my friends' parents smoked, but they still went outside.
Yeah.
So he just hated that he was the only one in the class that smelled like smoke.
That's fair. Yeah. My parents, they took a picture of my infant sister holding a beer and a cigarette with a hat on backwards. She must have been like 9 months old.
You know, that's okay.
Kids, when I was growing up, every parent had a picture of their kid's ass. Typically, you were climbing out of the bathtub.
Bathtub shots. I mean, there's probably 50 of those of me.
Let's see. Parents, they'd beat the hell out of us in public. Let us be home by ourselves well before any legal age to do the same. Believe it or not, man, we're doing a little research before the show. There's no specific legal age for leaving
for
your
kid
home for a latchkey kid.
Oh, really?
So if your kid's 4, I don't know that it's necessarily illegal. I'm not saying the cops won't come and visit you. CBS might have some things to say, but they said there's no guaranteed legal minimum age. I assume
from first grade on, I was a latchkey kid.
Yeah, I was too. I mean, up until like high school, I guess. But
For an hour or an hour and a half.
Yeah, I mean,
but you had things to do. My kids are kind of getting into the cooking game now, but they do it with my supervision. But growing up, say third, fourth grade, there's a note from your mom. Hey, you need to turn the oven on to this temperature, at this time to preheat for dinner, and you need to fire up the stove and put, boiling water on or something
also,
like that.
Also, wouldn't uncommon to come home and make yourself a grilled cheese sandwich or something like
for
that
sure.
And cook on the stove before, every kid eats constantly, so you're eating a meal before dinner.
That is very true.
I mean, I feel like, I don't know, what's first grade? 6, 7?
Six. Seven. About 7.
That seems young, but I feel like 9, 10, it's like, all right.
Then go ahead and do it.
Let me figure it out.
You're paying attention.
Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Danny. Welcome to the men's room.
Hi.
Hola.
Hola, guys. All right. So when I was about 6, back in the 90s, my parents moved to a foster commune, like a Christian foster commune in Chalupa, Oregon, on 108 acres to be foster parents. And there was about 7 houses with 5 to 10 kids in each house.
Damn.
And the adults after school, which was like at like 4, between 4 to about 7, which is when we had dinner, they would just leave us all outside, which is like,
great. And play the thing.
Once again, bedroom colors, here are the 7 words you can't say on the radio.
She's not wrong.
Sucker, mother, and... Please keep those words in mind when calling. Now, back to the program.
All right, Danny, so those older kids would mess with you.
They would mess with, the younger kids. I'm so sorry.
I'm sorry.
But it was, like, really bad. They would haunt us in the sun because, you know, in Oregon, it's, like, 90 degrees in the summer. And they would haunt us out and, like, leave us for those hours. Or they would tie us to trees and throw knives at us.
Jesus. Throw knives?
Oh, that's the Oregon way.
I mean, do you bring this up to the parents?
Oh, yeah. And they wouldn't believe us. They would believe the older kids.
Yeah, it's pretty messed up. That's way beyond my my childhood memories.
Did you live there until you were 18, or did your parents move again?
No. We left when I was 12 because I was bullied and had some, like, really bad, like, sex stuff happened to me.
Okay.
And I tried to end my life, and they left and got me counseling because I was messed up in the head. That's what they said. So.
How long did it take you to get past all that?
Well, I had a lot more happen to me when I was, like, a teenager, like. So, I'm still trying,
I guess,
but I don't want, like, I have three kids now, and I have had, like, a really negative view of people, and I'm really trying to make sure that my kids don't have that.
Sure, so. I understand.
What are some things, so you have three kids now, is there anything you took from your parents that you apply with your kids now, right? Because we always talk about the things we don't want to repeat that our parents did, but I also realize 50% of my parenting comes directly from things that they said or did when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah. Like, I mean, so I always think in my head, I don't want to be like my parents, but there are certain things that I'll end up saying to them.
Yep.
That, like, yeah.
Because it works.
It does, you know? But, like, I don't want to end up, my parents had this view of, like, really sheltering me, and it didn't work at all because I just learned those experiences without knowing anything about them.
Sure.
So, like, I really try to make sure that, like, my kids know about it, but not in the way that I've had it happen to me.
Yeah, teach them from your own experience.
Yeah, but, like, I love... My parents have done so many horrible things to me, but, like, my kids know about them because they're, like, older, and they're like, oh, why don't you just cut ties with them? And I'm like, you know, they're your grandparents. Like, I want, family's kind of all you have, you know?
Sure.
So.
Yeah, that's the thing about family.
Yeah, like, I tell them, hey, you know, yeah, they did these horrible things, and yes, you shouldn't trust them to a certain point, but they're also your family, just like your siblings, even if you don't like them. You know, at the end of it, when you have nothing else, like, you still should have something else.
Yeah, agreed. Mm-hmm. Agreed. Family can be tough. You know, it's funny. My kids, they brought this up to me. I did not ask. But my son's like, do you know the time that me and my sister were the angriest at you? Which is kind of a loaded question.
Yeah.
Because this came out of nowhere. So I'm just like, okay, here we go. I'm like, okay, what did I do? Now, it was good news to me by the time he was done. They were here at the radio station with me, all right? And it's one of them, my wife was working at the time. They had to be here for a couple hours, whatever. So my son's like, so you're working. And it's like, and I know we kept bugging you. They were probably like 4 and 5 years old. And like, you were pretty cool. And you took us back to your vending machine when we still had one 2 times. And he goes, but then the third time you asked, you turned around and said no. And he's like, and we were crushed. And I'm waiting for more of the story. And I'm like, is that it, man? He's like, yeah, but Dad, we were really pissed. The vending machine. He goes, yes. But I'd gotten you stuff out of there. Yeah. You just wanted more. He goes, yeah. I said, well, like Cheetos. He goes, uh-huh. And you wouldn't do it. I said, okay, look, man, if that's the worst I've done, I am okay with how your life's tracking. My apologies, you couldn't eat 3 bags of Cheetos that day.
Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
You know, when I was a kid, there was a couple times, and I don't know, whatever reason, like, my mom just didn't have another option. So she's like, you got to come to work with me.
All right.
Right? So, I mean, it was fine, because, like, there was, like, a computer. Do you guys remember Doom?
Duke. Yeah.
Duke was like one of the first like first person shooter games.
Sure.
It's like the tech guy was always kind of funny because he'd be like, oh, come over here. I'll show you this game. But the highlight is I get it as an adult now. You go to the building catty corner here. When you go get lunch, there's a bunch of options.
Yes.
But as a kid, you don't know this exists in the world, right? You eat lunch at school.
Right. And you get what they give you.
So, like, we walked to this place. It was like by the metro stop. And I mean, I just.
Chicken wings, pasta, pizza.
Right. And my mom was like, yeah, they have all these different kinds of stuff, right? I'm just like, oh my God, this is amazing.
Right.
You can get a slice of pizza. It's like being at the mall.
I want to work now.
Yeah, Chinese food. Exactly. I was like, I don't know why people don't work more.
Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803.
Right. Hello, Josh. Welcome to the men's room.
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Hola.
First of all, I want to thank you for all the entertainment you give to me.
Oh, thanks. We appreciate you listening.
So, long time ago, 24, 26 years ago, my dad used to let me drive his backhoe about a mile down to a friend's house. So building up all the confidence in the world, my mom let me drive at a base, must have been 11 or 12. Driving a stick as a young kid is different than an automatic. And
for sure.
I actually ran over a guy on a motorcycle, luckily on a private road.
But you ran over a guy?
Completely over a guy. I pinned him up against an 8x8 post.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
I should laugh. But.
Wait, and you said you're 11 or 12 when this happened?
Yes. My mom's in the passenger seat. I am driving, first time in a stick shift. And instead of hitting the brake, I kind of hit the gas. Second gear, fully pinned, and broken legs, broken ribs, broken arms. Luckily, not an upstanding citizen, so, you know, today would have been a little different. But I definitely didn't get any trouble, but definitely scarred me for life.
But wait a minute, what do you mean he wasn't an upstanding?
Yeah, it doesn't matter what his dude, deal is when right. You pin him up against the pole and break both of his legs and his ribs. I mean, he didn't do anything to you. He might not have been the best guy in the world, but he didn't deserve that.
If he was an upstanding citizen, I believe, you know, I probably would have gotten in trouble, but I don't even think he went to the hospital. I just remember him months after that recovering. So
how does this affect you now, like when you're driving? Are you a very cautious driver?
A little bit.
Do you drive a stick or an automatic?
I drive an automatic.
Okay. Yeah.
Learn that lesson.
What did your mom try to help the guy or anything?
Oh yeah, no, we had to get in the driver's seat and back it off of him.
Okay, well, what makes you believe that you don't know this guy? You just randomly ran over this guy on his motorcycle. What was the tell that this guy was not an upstanding citizen?
A neighbor, you know, on drugs. Just, like, I mean, not an upstanding citizen. Definitely not any. I believe he was probably warrants and whatnot, so.
Ah, okay.
All right.
So he didn't go to the hospital because he doesn't want his name in the system.
That's what I mean, yeah.
Even with two broken legs, are like, nope. Just let him heal at home.
Damn.
Well, damn, dude, that's a hell of a way to start driving. Yeah,
back in the day, what did your parents do that would not fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Don't worry, kid, you hit a drug dealer. It's
yeah,
cool.
I know.
Don't worry about it. You know, they don't feel pain.
Yeah, you guys sucked as a human.
Yeah, man.
Sure,
he got busted with weed, man. Kill him. You know, it's bad, man. Picking up food this morning, talking to my wife, she's like, hey, give me a little late. I said, it's okay. I think I already know what we're doing for a question today. She's like, what is it? And basically what we asked you, you know, what did parents do back in the day that wouldn't fly today? So she's kind of looking at me. And I go, man, just stuff, you know, like smoking in the car or riding in the pickup truck bed or like putting your kid on the lap and having them stare. She's like, your son did that yesterday. I'm like, what? We get to the driveway. He sits on my lap. He stared the car. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah,
maybe we should rephrase it to, or what shouldn't you do? Today that you do any damn way.
Well, I was 4 or 5
years
old.
We used to do it all the time.
I did
just
too.
Driving up our street.
Yeah. And she did it up. We got a fairly long-ish driveway. And I get it. I know he has done it before. But still, I'm like, my God, babe. I'm giving you examples of things.
Yeah. All you got to do is press the gas accidentally. Right? Like my grandfather.
No, he's not doing the pedals.
Oh, he's just
doing
the
steering.
Well,
yes.
My grandfather used to let me sit on his lap and steer.
Yeah.
Get a Volkswagen Beetle. I could see out the window at this point in time because I'm on his lap. So I was just steering. But if
but
I
didn't have power steering, right?
No.
Much different.
But that's all you know is the steering wheel in front of you. So, he'd just wait for a straightaway, then let me drive and let me steer. And he'd say, mate, you really don't have to touch the wheel that much. I remember that. And then when I was done driving, he would put me in the front seat. But because of my height, I could not see over the dashboard. Now, even at that point in time in my life, I still have motion sickness and vertigo. I was the kid that always got car sick based on the switchbacks and the roads in West Virginia and everything else. I needed to see ahead so that I would not get sick.
Okay.
With emotion. I just needed, my brain needed to
compute. Did your brother believe you?
What's that?
When you were a kid. One of my siblings used to always try, and I'd be like, get in the back seat. I called shotgun. You're not getting car sick.
Right, yeah.
You're just lying because you want to sit up front.
Well, I would stand because if I sat down in the front seat, I couldn't see. So I would stand up in the front seat of the car, no matter where we went, driving down the road so I could see. I mean, stand straight up in the seat. That's the only way I ever traveled with my grandfather.
But nobody cared then.
No.
You know, it's isn't that cute?
Christmas lights. Anything that I needed to see something.
Right.
I was always standing up in the car. I thought it was great. Only my grandfather would let me do it. Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
I mean, my parents didn't do it, but I definitely remember driving with other people's parents, and they just blatantly were sipping on cans of beer in the car.
I was telling Steve this yesterday. Back in the early 70s, mid-70s, one of the things that became popular in homes for people who wanted to add something onto the kitchen was the equivalent of a little Nook wet bar, which might be close to the dining room, close to the kitchen, whatever the deal is. And that had a little tiny sink in it, but all your mixing stuff,
glasses hanging up.
Yeah, glasses up top or liquor up top and a cabinet down below. And my grandfather had one of those things. And my grandfather loved his mixed drinks. And he would go make, anytime we were going anywhere, he would go over there and with a glass, with ice. Jesus.
Yeah.
He would make a mixed drink. And I still remember the sound of the ice rattling in the car. Anywhere we went, he would just he'd drink gin and tonic, whatever the hell he was drinking. It was just his drink to go where he needed to get.
But it wasn't illegal then, right?
I don't know. 1975, 76.
What year was it like?
I don't know.
I think it was late 70s when you weren't ever supposed to drive drunk, but you can't have an open beer in your vehicle.
Montana was the last, I think. I think they were the last bastion of, if you're not drunk, you can still have a beer open.
Still have a beer open. But I remember we were watching a video from back in the day, and it was just a typical local newscast, wherever state they're in, I don't know. But the law, I don't think the law had been implemented yet, but it had been voted on that that's going to be the case. And just hearing the backlash of everybody. And they all basically said
it was like
seatbelts.
Seatbelts drinking. All the people.
The guy with the beer, he was like, you're telling me I work a goddamn 8-hour day at the factory and I can't just blow off steam when I'm stuck in traffic on the freeway. We're only doing 60 miles an hour that I can't drink a beer. And at the time, that argument kind of made sense
because
that's what you'd always done. Hearing it now, I'm like, this dude sounds like a lunatic
because
it's been so beaten into our heads. I mean, he kind of has a point, but no one could believe. There was a woman on there like,
I have to take my children to the grocery store, and they act up in the back of the car. Why can't I drink a margarita on the way there?
It was like a news report.
Yeah, I mean, certainly people, but it was everybody,
I mean, it is strange that, you can go to a bar, right, depending on your weight.
Mm-hmm.
Like, most people, and there's charts. You can look them up all the time. You can figure out how many beers you can have, right? Like, can you have 2 beers an hour and still be legal to drive? But you're right. But if you were just cruising around with an open can, you're like, what are you doing?
Even if it's like just one Coors Light, man, that's all I'm going to drink, right? I couldn't get drunk off of a single Coors Light if my life depended on it. But still, you're going to jail, man.
Oh, I've just seen it on I-5. I've seen, you passing somebody and you're going, you're like, that's a Coors Light can. What are you doing, dude?
I mean, I can see the appeal. It's a Friday night. It's a nice day. You just finished off a day of work. It's like, yeah, I know it sounds good.
I absolutely get the appeal.
Yeah.
But I get the appeal of illegal drugs, prostitution, drinking a beer in your car. I get the appeal of all of it.
But as soon as you're not in a vehicle, but you might be operating a vehicle, but as long as it's not a car, when you go down to the dunes, right?
Right.
Coos Bay.
Yeah.
Guarantee 90% of those people have had a few in them. Snowmobilers.
Oh, God, yeah.
Had a few in them. Guys doing,
It was us.
Guys on lawnmowers. I mean, people who are boating. I'm not saying it's right. I'm just saying it just seems.
It happens a lot.
Yes. Back in the day, what did your parents do that would not fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
It's warming up, folks, and about time to turn on your AC unit and cross your fingers. Or you can give up that moment of truth and switch to an American Standard heat pump system like I did. My place is on comfort autopilot thanks to American Standard. Energy efficient and reliable, my heat pump keeps things cool like the Arctic in the summer. And with energy incentives, I was able to save. Ready for the future of comfort? Learn more at AmericanStandardAir.com/electrification.
Tired of fine lines and wrinkles? Dermaclara has the solution. Our 100% medical-grade silicone patches are designed to naturally reduce wrinkles and improve skin texture. Safe, effective, and reusable, these patches deliver visible results in as little as 20 minutes and lasting results in just 30 days. Our customers rave about their transformations. Plus, with our satisfaction guarantee, you can try Dermacare risk-free. Discover the power of natural skincare at Dermaclara.com and say hello to youthful, radiant skin.
Start your summer road trip at Midas and get up to $30 off your next repair service. Plus, get a free closer look vehicle check to make sure you're road trip ready. So if you need a brake service, an alignment check, or tune-up, hit up Midas for up to $30 off. For more details, request your appointment at Midas.com.
Yeah, I got an Ecobee smart home, and nosy Ned next door comes over to see. I told him about Ecobee. Turns out Ecobee's a lot smarter than his better-known smart home. I told him, Ned, get yourself a smarter home. Visit Ecobee.com today.
99.9 KISW. The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill.
Return of Ted versus the FCC coming up right after emails on our question on this positive Friday back in the day.
What did your parents do that would not fly today?
206-803-ROB.
Quick question for you guys. In what year do you believe that drunk driving was finally made illegal in all 50 states?
I'll say 1982 or 3.
In all 50 states?
All 50 states, drunk driving finally made illegal.
96.
2002.
1988.
2002, damn. I was only off by 4 years, dude.
Yeah,
1988.
So close.
Oh, 88.
I
thought he said 98,
no.
My bad.
Hello, Dane. Welcome to the men's room.
How's it going, guys? Hola.
Hola.
Yeah, fun fact, really quick, before we get to it. I love you guys' show.
Oh, thank you, man.
We have two open containers in Missoula, Montana, up until, 2016?
Yeah, I was going to say, it's pretty recent there.
That was
yeah.
the last one.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, just, but yeah, anywho, what happened as a kid that would not fly now?
Yeah.
What happened?
I was allowed to go outside, no cell phones, no anything. This is the 90s, and the rule was just come home on time. Get home before the sun set.
Before the sun set. All right. So what was
so
your...
I just disappear for 3, 4, 5 hours, depending on the time of the year.
Yeah, I think a lot... Right. The winter time kind of sucked because the sun went down so much earlier. But no, you're right, man. And most of the kids, I knew that was the case because, again, it's just landline phones. They didn't have cell phones. So we would make arrangements ourselves, typically in the morning, whether it's the weekend or summer. And then I would just say, I'm leaving. The parents, they never said good, but that's pretty much what they meant. And again, you did not see them until you came home.
The Weisses that lived probably easily a half mile away from me, they had two kids, Joey and Pokey.
Pokey?
Pokey, yeah.
That was the kid's name.
Pokey.
Was that his name or his nickname?
That's his name.
Jesus.
Gumby was big.
Pokey was his name, yeah.
But right, that was the horse on Gumby.
You think Gumby was so big that people said, I'm going to name my child
after that? Yes.
After Gumby's horse.
Yes, I do.
They did not have a farm or anything like that. They had a big piece of property.
Right.
But they had a dinner bell. And when that dinner bell rang, you know, Joey and Pokey had to go home. Now, typically, depending on whose friend group we were with, the parents would instruct the same thing. They would say, look, when the Weisses ring the dinner bell, that's your cue to come home, too.
Sure.
So four people would take off down the hill, you know, when that bell went off. And that it was normal then, but now I look back, golly, a dinner bell? Ring a dinner bell?
Yeah, yeah, we did have one family that did that. We were not obligated to their dinner bell, but yeah.
I wasn't either.
When they heard it, we knew that they were leaving. The thing that killed me as a kid, man, and because kids still get up to no good. And again, we weren't the worst kids in the world, but since you would get your ass beat if you were caught doing anything, it would happen. So during the summer, we typically went down toward my buddy Devin's house, and we do whatever we do. And maybe once a week did we get busted doing something we shouldn't. But his parents would beat all of our asses. And then they've made the phone call to my parents. So by the time I get home, because, you know, the play day is over now, right? Ride my bike home. I get home. My parents are pissed off because they got a call from my friend's mom. And then they beat my ass. And I'm like, man, I'm getting my ass beat twice. So by the middle of the summer, we started telling Devin, hey, dude, you need to play closer to our houses. That way, if we get busted, we only get our ass beat once because you're only getting one ass whipping from your parents. But
that's
they also,
the only time
but they also whipped our ass. And then when we get home, each of us collectively got another ass whipping. So we're getting two ass whippings to your one ass whipping. This is grossly unfair.
The only time I ever got like spanked by somebody else's parent, like I got chewed out by other people's parents.
Plenty.
But my buddy, I remember like it was yesterday. I'm sitting on the back, like the pickup truck is parked in his dad's driveway.
All right.
So I don't know what we were doing. We're just hanging out on the tailgate. But like he's walking towards me and he said something kind of like mouthing off to his dad. I could see his dad speeding up and like his arm moving. So I'm like, hey man, like turn around. And man, his dad was pissed.
All right.
Because he was like, this is how I disciplined my kid. Like, you can't give him a heads up. And I'm like, oh, it was just like a normal reaction though. So I was just like, oh, Mike, turn around.
He was mad that you gave him a heads up.
Correct. So his kid got hit, and then he gave me one for good measure.
Damn.
Because he was like, don't.
I guess that's
right. Like, I'm disciplined. And I'm like, all right.
Well, we got a text from a guy who grew up in Texas, and he said, you'd get your ass beat by complete strangers if you were doing the wrong thing.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
That's very much a Texas way. But oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I can see that. Just knowing the Texas side of my family, my dad's side. There's a million of them, but yeah, just in the neighborhood, if it's a little kid and you get out of line, whether they know you or not,
Zap.
Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Milo. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, guys.
Hola.
Yeah, I grew up in the 80s, so back when I was a kid in the mid-80s, my parents, along with everything else everybody else has talked about, my parents would let me run around the woods as a feral child with a machete at like 5 and 6 years old.
Did you ever hurt yourself?
I got cuts, but I have all 10 toes and fingers, and so do my siblings.
Man, well, there's something different about, I feel like if you live on, because we lived in the woods for a while, we also live near farmland, and people are a lot more lax because people are a lot more self-reliant in a way, right? Mm-hmm. Everything you do, you got to figure it out for yourself. So with the kids, you don't realize how much independence you have. Your parents didn't check on you. They didn't worry about you. You made it home. And right, you could have all these sharp things.
Oh, yeah.
They weren't particularly worried about it. There were always guns in the garage, but you just knew. Yep. Don't mess with, I mean, we're never clear about it.
22 leaning in the corner.
Yeah, always. But they said, don't mess with these things. And then when I moved to the city, when we got to Baltimore, all the rules change because there's so many people. You can't really disappear in the woods. Like, your parents know you're up to no good, but if no one can see what you're doing, it kind of doesn't matter sort of thing. And the city, we couldn't do it. And there were guns everywhere there, none of them legal. Much a different issue. So that's when rules got a little tighter for me. We're just surrounded by crazy people.
We had machetes just to take down weeds. So you go out there and hack it down. Also, we had a big-ass sickle, you know, like the Grim Reaper would use, two-handed, where you just swing it like this. And
so
my buddies had throwing stars. They had blowguns. They had spears and all that crap that they were just collecting because they were into it.
And it gave you something to do. And you have trees to throw it at. I mean, it's such a different thing when you live out there. And as a kid, I think it's a much better existence.
Mm-hmm. My dad would also give us his boxing gear, and we would go down the basement and just beat the living hell out of each other.
Yeah. Sure.
He'd show us how to tie the gloves up. Everybody would. We had a big, like, 12-ounce, maybe, Everlast, or six, the biggest ones you could get.
Yeah.
So
14, 16,
it still hurt.
Yeah.
Trust me, but,
I look like Mike Tyson in his gloves the other day.
Did that surprise you? Red,
white, and blue.
How bad a boxing glove, as a kid, for some reason, when you're watching boxing, when you're really young, you think they put on the gloves, it's going to feel like a balloon, right? In spite of the fact these guys are bloody knocking each other up. So you get it in your head that like, oh, I don't know, it's like a big balloon. Then you put on boxing gloves and your buddy hits you and you're like, it's really not like a balloon at all.
Oh, my butt.
That hurts.
Yeah, when you're like sparring's one thing, but when you're actually boxing, if you don't have your hands taped correctly, so you'll still, your hand's going to hurt.
Yeah. Oh, Ted, man, my buddy Pat, he could throw a great jab, but he missed me one time. With the meat of the glove and stuck the thumb in my eye, you know, like he just missed the side. And I mean, it would. And I thought I was blind. I thought he blinded me.
Yeah,
I would have rather been punched with the glove than take a thumb to the eye on a punch.
You see it every once in a while when you're watching a professional boxing match, and you'll see a guy.
Oh my god! It feels like your eyes gonna pop out of your head
to the face. he keeps boxing. Like you said, that hand slips and the thumb hits his eye. It's like, all right, time out.
Yeah.
Right? You just, you can't recover. But
I used to practice downstairs. I practiced on the speed bag. So the next time we went down there, I started to fight. Speed bag has nothing to do with boxing.
No.
It's just a rhythm thing. It has nothing to do
with. It is a rhythm thing.
Right. It has nothing to do with.
It will
not
help you
fighting.
Fight.
It's not going to help. It makes you look cool.
Oh, for sure.
But, and it's good. I mean, it's a good workout, but you're right. It's not going to help you with power or how to throw a punch or anything like
that. The only thing it makes sure that you do is gives you the stamina to remember to keep your hands up.
Yes.
That's basically it with a weight.
Correct.
That's it. Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Beth. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola.
Hola.
In the, about 74, 75, I was 15. My girlfriend and I, we got a planter's peanut jar and filled it up with all different kinds of booze from her parents' closet and went to the high school football game and then over behind Shakey's in Fedaway then and continued to drink it like it was water. I was not in a good place. I was really bad. And so my mom picked us up and my dad beat me really bad all night long, and I didn't know that he did that all night long until 30 years later my sister and my girlfriend that I was with told me about it. My girlfriend never got in trouble because she said that my mom and dad would have gotten in trouble for my dad beating me, but you know,
but you have no recollection of that?
No, I don't. I don't remember him beating me at all that time. He beat me all the time, but not
how,
that time.
How old were you?
15.
And you don't remember, huh?
No.
Oh, that would have stuck in my head. Because
were you
15 years old?
Yeah,
I'm
but
the
trauma, that's the way trauma works sometimes. Yeah. You don't even realize it. You're mentally blocking it out.
Okay.
You think it's trauma or you were drunk or both?
Both.
Okay. I mean, look.
Even when I'm drunk, I remember when I get my ass beat.
That's the best beating to take is the one you don't remember.
Yeah, exactly. Wake up and go, oh, God. Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
That was the other guy. He's fine, dude. You took the beat.
He's like, fine.
Go look in the mirror.
Honestly, no, there's nothing prideful. He was shorter, smaller. He just got you.
He just needed ice for his knuckles because it kept connecting with your face.
Yeah. Also, I'm pretty sure he did leave with your girlfriend.
Yeah.
And one of your teeth lodged in his knuckle.
Anyhow, you want to go get some brunch?
It's all good, man. Don't worry.
I can't chew.
We're still buds.
Hello, Nick. Welcome to the men's room.
How's it going?
Hola.
So, back in the late 80s, early 90s, I lived in Arizona, and me and my dad and sometimes my friends or my brother, we take our Jeep out in the desert in the middle of the night, the shotgun and a spotlight, and he'd be drinking and we'd be shooting snakes as we were driving around. Well, I was driving around and we were hunting out snakes in the desert.
Were they on your property?
Nope. This is all out in the middle of the boonies.
So you're just killing them for fun?
Killing rattlesnakes.
Okay.
At night.
So your dad was shooting, you were driving. Did he say, look, you can't shoot because that would be dangerous?
No, I was shooting. He was just drinking.
Oh,
he was just drinking. That's all he was doing.
Okay.
How many rattlesnakes would you kill a night?
Sometimes we get like 6 or 7. Sometimes we only get like 2.
Okay.
And how many times do you think you did this? Was this like a nightly thing in the summer or what?
This was probably every weekend in the summer. So I would say at least 50, 60 times.
What were you shooting? Like a 30-06 or something?
20-gauge shotgun.
Okay.
Damn.
And now, then, rattlesnake hunting.
Do you have kids of your own?
Yes, I do, and we do the same. And we did the same thing as he was growing up.
Yeah, I was going to ask you. Did you do the same thing?
Oh yeah, but see, the thing is, the difference is, there's one time that we didn't know it that there was somebody. They were searching for somebody with a 4-wheel drive vehicle with a shotgun, and we just happened to fit that description. And I was driving, but luckily the sheriff knew my dad and was like, "Just get your drunk butt home. Don't." Talk about this. Just go home and get it over with. And this was probably about 95, 96 when this happened.
Okay.
All right. Damn.
Well, at least they weren't looking for you.
Like I said, if you're living out in the cut, man, it's just a dumb thing. Damn. Sorry, text here says, my mom dropped me and 2 siblings off, ages 8 to 12, at Circus in Las Vegas while she went to the Riviera. She gave each kid a roll of quarters, just told us not to leave.
Gambling?
I don't wonder what year that is, because I can't imagine any Vegas casinos like, Yeah, they're young, but they're not drinking. They're just playing slots.
I mean, can the kid play but I think slots? Circus Circus always had, like, the merry-go-round. Like, they had some other stuff.
Oh,
there
were
some
do, kid like, video games and stuff like that.
Yeah, and, like, I feel like that, the first time I went to Vegas, we went in there. They even have, like, little, like, you know, funnel cakes, this and that.
Okay. Can the kid play a slot machine or no?
No. You got to be 18 to gamble.
Okay.
Our parents used to drop us off at the mall, or one of our friend's parents, and we could go for 4 hours. We go see. Sometimes we saw two movies back to back, or whatever.
Yeah, parents didn't care. They didn't watch home.
That mall was a babysitting machine, and everybody in there, I knew half the people in there because they were all my age. It was almost like dropping the kids off at Wild Waves instead of taking them to daycare.
That's basically, you know. And
at least on the weekends, the mall went.
But when I was a kid, you know, I always reflected on that as, man, my parents were really, really cool when I was growing up. They had no problem dropping me and my brother off, like you said, go to the mall, go to the movie, call us at, you know, 7 or whatever the hell, when you're done. And I remember recalling this. I'm in my 20s now, talking to someone like, oh, my parents are real cool with that. Then it occurred to me, I'm like, oh, they just wanted us out of the house.
Well, sometimes
this wasn't anything about being nice. This is just like, cool, you don't want to be home.
Sometimes the parents, they would watch a movie, the first one, the same time we would. They would go see a different movie, that was appropriate for them or one they wanted to see. But then they would take off when they were done, and they would come back 2 to 3 hours later. We needed to watch another movie. We occupied ourselves. We went to the arcade.
Yeah, you know, it's on something.
We go to the food court.
We only got in trouble because we used to go to the movies on, like, I think it was like Friday nights or Saturday nights. And like, same thing, my mom would drop me off. But we got in trouble because we didn't go to the movie we were supposed to.
Did you what? Go to like an R-rated movie or just a different movie?
We went to see White Man Can't Jump.
All right.
And I guess, I don't, you know, just the title, you don't know what the movie is.
Based on where you lived, yeah.
Right. So I guess they didn't want us to be the only four white people in there. I don't know. We went to see it. We thought it was awesome. Obviously, nothing happened.
Right.
It's a comedy.
How did they find out you saw it?
Oh, the next day at practice, me and Nick, we couldn't stop talking about it. Like, yeah, we seen it, dude. Yeah. And I mean, there is, obviously, that's a rated R movie. There's sexual stuff and everything.
Is that,
like,
your Rosie Perez moment?
That is one of them.
No, it was the one with Mork. What's his name? Robin Williams.
No. Rosie Perez, her nipple and Do the Right Thing.
Do the Right Thing.
But her being in White Man Can't Jump did not hurt her status in my mind.
It's just her nipple. And it's always been the nipple with you. You've never said, first time I saw boobs, it's specifically Rosie Perez's nipple.
Yeah. Well, that's why because when we would go to watch the first movie, the parents would typically be with us when we went in.
Sure.
We would buy the ticket to the movie that we were going to go see.
Right. Correct.
But as kids by yourself, when you went back to pay for another movie, you didn't even need to go and sneak out of one theater into the other. There was no law. Rated 18 years of age older is what's recommended.
Recommended, right.
Recommended. You did not need to have...
Is it a law? Can a kid go to a rated R movie?
Without parental... In theory, it's supposed to be,
but
if you're not 17 and there's no parent or guardian with you, I don't know what the fine would be, but essentially it just comes down to the movie theater itself. Like, kids, we can't sell you the ticket.
Right.
That's all. But if I show up and buy them four, they're like, I'm not going to sit to this movie with them. I'm just saying it's cool. Typically, they'll let you do it. Has been my experience.
Yeah, no one ever questioned it. Any movie you wanted to go see, because half the time it was like Friday the 13th.
Of course.
Halloween. Those type of movies where it's like, yeah, of course. Kids go to horror movies. That's even though it's rated R because you're going to see a couple boobs.
Which is ridiculous. I feel like kids are the biggest audience, especially for the slasher ones.
Yeah. Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Ed. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola, big kids.
Hola.
So, yeah, just the age difference between now and when my parents got married, like, my dad was 28, 29. My mom was, like, 15. And my grandparents, even the same thing. I think my grandfather and my grandmother have kind of a wider age range. But, like, back then it was socially acceptable, where now if you do that, you're a pedophile, you're going to prison, bud.
Yep. Yeah, that's correct. That's all true. And the marriage age was much younger, and that was not uncommon.
Not at all. Basically, it seemed like, again, and Miles, I know you're in the same boat, but both of our mothers were about 19 when they had their first kid, which sounds crazy to me now, but I've known that my whole life. But, like, again, talking to the grandmothers, like, well, I was 17 when I had your mom. It seemed perfectly normal. And I just assumed that, hey, man, so my dad would have been 22. So I'm thinking, all right, well, when I'm 22 years old, I'm going to be a father. That's just how it works.
And astonishingly enough, you know, if you were to look at that now, if even my daughter now, it's 24 years old. I'd be like, you're too young to get married. Well, I was 4, you know, at that age when my mom had me. But those relationships seem to last.
My parents were still, I mean, 60 freaking years old, man.
Everybody has ups and downs, and people make mistakes through life, but it was forgiven, it was moved on, or whatever. If someone was, you know, committed infidelity or whatever the deal was, you worked your way out.
Or murdered them.
You figured it out, and you moved on, and you stuck together. And, you know, sometimes, I'm going to wait to make sure that I do the right thing, and blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to get married until I'm 30 or whatever, 35 years old. And then you're divorced in like 3 years.
Right. I mean, there's no formula.
I'm waiting to make sure it's the right time for me, and I can take care of a family, and I make enough money to have kids if I want.
I think it's more of this. Sow your wild oats. Don't worry about it. I have a career, have the money. Maybe you will, maybe you won't. You can't really predict that. But what you do know is in your 20s, or at least I can look back at my 20s now and say, yeah, man, you didn't need to be in any long-term relationship in your 20s.
It is hard to look at where you're at versus where your parents are at and not feel a little bit behind, though. By the time
home ownership, all that stuff.
Right, by the time my dad was my age, he was already working on his second house, his bigger house, because he already had all three of his kids and was moving up at where he was working at.
Yeah, I mean, so by the time I moved out, 5 years younger than my brother, when I moved out, my parents were in their late 40s, early 50s, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 55.
Right.
My oldest kid is 13 and a half.
I still can't believe, though, when you guys moved out, your parents kept buying bigger houses. Like, why do you need a five-bedroom house? Why do you need a
four-bedroom? They don't buy bigger houses. They just bought cooler houses. And you got to understand, too, you know, we live in Seattle, so housing prices are exorbitantly stupid, right? You spend all that money to get nothing. They're like, well, we got the cash. We can buy what the F we want when we're not in Seattle. That's part of the reason they ended up leaving, last year, I think it was. It's a lot. It's... We've been here 10 years with the grandkids. We love them. We got to go.
Yep. Back in the day, what did your parents do that wouldn't fly today? 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Jeff. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Hola. Very good, Jeff. Positive Friday. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for keeping me smiling all the time. Positive.
So what did your parents do back in the day that wouldn't fly?
Well, my parents had their hands full, and my mom, God bless her, we had eight kids, and she'd take us out to go to the grocery store or go to, the Sears store to get clothes and things like that. And whatever she had in her hand, if you deserved it, you were getting a smack.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
So she'd pull the wooden hanger right off the rack and give you a couple of smacks, and you turn and look at the cashier who's looking at you and giving your mom the thumbs up for teaching that brat a lesson.
Yeah, you didn't get a whole lot of sympathy back in the day, man. If you got hit, you earned it.
My older brother used to pick on me so that I would cause a fuss, and then I would be the one getting a spanking, and by the time we got to be high schoolers, I was able to kick his ass, so it was funny. Yeah, yeah.
Good times. Metallica tickets every day in May. It's coming up, 420. Listen for that code word, the secret word. And text that to 206-803-ROCK. Ted versus the FCC coming up. And your emails to the men's room at KISW.com next.
Are you a fan of mystery and adventure? Introducing June's Journey, the captivating free-to-play mobile game that will ignite your inner detective. Play as June Parker in a thrilling murder mystery adventure as you search for hidden objects to uncover the truth behind her sister's death. Step into the glamorous world of the Roaring Twenties with stunningly illustrated scenes and over 1,000 mysteries to unravel. With new chapters added weekly, you'll never run out of clues to chase and suspects to interrogate. Plus, you can build your own island escape with beautiful gardens and buildings, and even join a detective club to collaborate with other players. Experience the thrill of being a detective and unravel the mystery in June's Journey. Download June's Journey now on your Android or iOS device, or play on PC through Facebook Games.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic. With four vibrant and refreshing flavors, pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
It's warming up, folks, and about time to turn on your AC unit and cross your fingers. Or you can give up that moment of truth and switch to an American Standard heat pump system like I did. My place is on comfort autopilot thanks to American Standard. Energy efficient and reliable, my heat pump keeps things cool like the Arctic in the summer. And with energy incentives, I was able to save. Ready for the future of comfort? Learn more at AmericanStandardAir.com/electrification.
Are you ready to unleash superior seating performance in your operation? Choose from two revolutionary Great Plains drills. The BD7600 Mintil Drill, renowned for its seating consistency, large capacity, and innovative technology, including Drill Command. And the new BD7410 Drill, whose transport width under 10 feet delivers great maneuverability through gates and down narrow roadways. Each model is engineered for the proven performance you've come to expect from Great Plains.
Welcome to Nada Yada Island.
This season on Nada Yada Island.
When we were new, they spoiled me. They even gave me a phone. But then, it's like I didn't exist.
Don't take Yada Yada from your wireless carrier. Now with Metro, get that new customer feeling again and again. Introducing Metro Flex. Free 5G phones when you join, same deals as new customers when you stay. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Just bring your number and ID and sign up for an eligible plan. After 12 months, trade in and get our best deals on select devices.
I had so many ideas to add to my journal, but would forget by the time I got home. Then I found Zinnia, the app that easily helps me record special moments and ideas, track my goals, schedule self-care moments, and document things that matter most. Zinnia makes creating content and ideas across screens so easy. Zinnia has so many cute journal templates, habit trackers, to-do lists, weekly logs, and more. I use my iPhone on the go and then switch to my iPad to edit, add photos, and draw. Then I can add directly to my socials. Download Zinnia on the App Store today.
For the ones who know safety isn't a catchphrase, it's a culture. And the ones who help make sure everyone makes it home safe. For the safety-minded who watch everyone's backs, Grainger offers supplies and solutions for every industry, as well as safety assessments and training to keep your facilities safe and your people safer. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Here are three reasons why Kate Farms Nutrition Shakes will take you one step closer to achieving your nutrition goals. For starters, every shake is made with high-quality ingredients and organic plant-based pea protein. So skip all the sugar alcohols, artificial flavors and colors, and enjoy three delicious flavors of certified goodness. Each Kate Farms Nutrition Shake is designed for easy digestion and can be enjoyed as a meal replacement, snack, or base for your favorite smoothie. And if you're not sold yet, each grab-and-go shake has a resealable twist-off cap for easy on-the-go nutrition. Ready to start thriving? Learn more at www.katefarms.com.
What's up? It's your boy, Ted Smith from the Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
All right, so cut off minutes. We'll drink a toast in the weekend with a shout of the day. Then it's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
And today we celebrate Armed Forces Day, which is tomorrow on a Bad Choice Friday with the Village People.
In the Navy.
Village People and In the Navy taking on the band known as the Gap Band. Vote now. Minutes to go there on the Bad Choice Friday. Choices: Village People, In the Navy, and the Gap Band. You dropped a bomb on me. Vote now if you follow us on Twitter at Men's Room Live.
So is he turned on by the bomb being dropped on him?
I think he liked the bomb being dropped.
Okay. You know what he's into.
I think that was covered in one of the Dirty Big Dummies.
Drop that bomb.
Vote now for Bad Choice Friday, coming up right after we drink a toast with a shot of the day. Okay, do we have time for a few emails from the Men's Room at KISW.com?
You've got mail. You've got mail.
One thing from our question here. Mom would use the back of her hand and the wooden spoon to discipline you. With that, I had plenty of those broke across my ass when I was younger. Dad was the guy with the pointed cowboy boots while they were still on his feet, kicking you in the ass. That from Debbie. As we jump into the birthdays. Guys, I hear you guys doing birthday announcement. I have twins turning 12 years old today, Haley and Austin. They would love it if you said happy birthday to them. That from Christina. How about a little kid fish sandwich? That seems fish appropriate sandwich. For 12. Birthday shout out for Torben again. Guys, I'd love for you to read the exact same birthday shout out that I sent in last year.
Ooh,
okay, way to be active.
I'll explain. I had been put on a heart medication that made me infuriatingly dumb. Life was one of those why did I walk in here moments. So I got my kid's age wrong. After hearing it, he only texted me, homie, I'm 19. Switched heart medication soon after that. So here's the original email, because actually this is the birthday.
So this is the one she sent last year.
Yeah. Okay. Guys, it is my son Torben's 20th birthday. He's beautiful, considerate, creative, hardworking kid with a sharp wit. Keeps me laughing, knows how to fix aircraft, and is a phenomenal plane spotter and photographer. He is studying in Germany, which is way too far away from the mama bear. He is my entire heart, but he's rocking it. So how about an OG fish sandwich and the dirty Germans talking about working on fuselages? Maybe Coach Ted giving him advice on entering his 20s. Mama loves you, kiddo. Many thanks. That from Trista.
Do I get a fish sandwich?
Yeah, when you bring up the fuselage, only picture one part of your body, and I will be visiting it with my sausage.
Yeah, so you know, it's funny. See, fuselage does remind me of a girl I once knew.
Oh, yeah.
Lots of people in there.
Oh.
All right, how old's he turning, Miles? 20?
20.
All right. You got one more year. Now listen, this year will be weird. You'll be sitting around going, hey, everybody else is 21, and they go to the bars. Don't sweat it, man. Trust me, you'll be 21 in no time, go to whatever bars. But also, you're probably in Germany, it sounds like. So, yeah, couldn't talk. Go drink a beer. I don't think they care.
Good afternoon, Bacholas. I think it's 18 there. Is it 16? Parental supervision, maybe?
I 18, maybe at 16.
I think you can drink at home. Good afternoon, Bacholas. Friday, today, my girlfriend's 23rd birthday. She's going to be going to school for a visit to learn about their cooking and baking program, as she loves doing both. So how about Coach Ted pumping her up for culinary school, shotgun gets, a bong rip, and Mike Hawk dad jokes? You got a couple you can throw out there? Thanks so much. That from Ethan.
Get.
All right, culinary school. First of all, get ready to buy some knives. You're going to need good ones. Second of all, get ready to judge your friends, as their cooking will now suck. Third of all, get that degree all you want. You're still going to have to be a line cook and learn the right way.
And if you're really going to cook, this comes in handy.
It really does.
Just the stress of restaurants, man. Just be high.
Just the only thing you have to remember, don't forget what you put in the oven.
All right. I do love a good dad joke, and you know what? I'll give you some Enum Claw-themed dad jokes here. What did the horse say after it tripped?
What did the horse say after it tripped?
Help, I've fallen and I can't giddy up.
All right, that's not bad.
What do you call a well-balanced horse?
A well-balanced horse.
Stable. Jesus. And finally, what do you call an angry carrot?
Angry carrot.
A steamed veggie.
Hey, he's pissed.
Yes. Gentlemen, it's my lovely lady's 30th trip around the sun. Can I get her the D, turtle sex, and the dirty Germans telling her what her tarot cards will predict for tonight? Happy Friday. That from Angel.
She wants a D, and she's going to get one.
Yeah, I know one of the tarot cards, and the major arcanum would be the hangman, which would be very fitting because tonight somebody's going to be hanging brain.
Yeah, you know, it's in Germany. I don't know too much about these tarot cards, but does one have a penis on it? Such might be the one you're getting.
Yeah, new card.
New card. Penis.
Jesus. All right, what else we got? Guys,
You have not seen that one, have you, Mike?
No.
My 31st birthday, I am spending it getting my house ready for my bestie to come visit me for the weekend. Can you give me the dirty Germans talking about a 31-year-old growing into her woman body, a bong rip, and a you like that? Thanks, guys. Much love to you all. That from Andrea.
You like that? You like that?
Yeah, first of all, I find it very hard to be two women there, but it's funny you bring up growing into your body, which is a German game we play. We go and flaccid, and then we grow into your body as well.
Yeah, I think the funny part is they're having the sleepover, or as we call it in Deutschland, Sizzlefest.
Eric needs some dad jokes from Miles. Feel guilty for going out of town on his birthday, but some bad jokes should help simulate me for being there. Can someone also say my meat is burned? I think it's usually Miles who says that over the song from Katie. Thanks, yay.
Meat is burned.
Sometimes I wonder what age it is appropriate to tell a highway that it was adopted. What did the bees hold after moving into their new hive?
What did the bees hold after moving into their new hive?
Housewarming party.
Nice.
And I'm only friends with 25 letters of the alphabet.
Why?
I don't know why.
Oh, I see.
Dude, so my husband, Jeremy, a.k.a. Psycho, just now told me he would love to get a fart montage. Dad jokes for Miles and some turtle sex. He is 47 today and doing delivery for Amazon, so let's make his day. Thanks, guys. That from Jana. Why shouldn't you bother telling sheep jokes to a border collie?
Why?
He heard them all.
He already heard them
he
all.
He already heard them. All right.
Well done. Boom. Boom. By the way, guys, I just want to tell you that becoming a vegetarian was a big missed mistake. Gentlemen, I'd like to wish my sister Barbie Ann a very happy birthday today because I always confuse it with Mount St. Helens eruption on the 19th or the 18th. She's gotten a few belated birthdays because of my brain slip. Hey, Barb, I remembered this time. Side note on the subject today. I know sis will remember well how mom could whoop our asses with a wooden spoon until it broke. Good times. So can I get a fart montage? Some jokes from Miles as well. Thanks, guys. Love you. Best damn show on the radio. That from David.
God.
Guys, you know,
that one's always gross.
You know, my friends say I'm the cheapest person that they know.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I'm not buying it. Why did the guy wake up with stir fry all over him?
Why did the guy wake up with stir fry all over him?
Because he was sleepwalking.
Walking.
Yeah, it looks orange and sounds like a parrot.
Oh. What's carrot? Carrot.
Carrot, that is correct. Yes, carrot. And one more. This is cool considering tomorrow's Armed Forces Day. It says, gentlemen, today marks a special occasion as we celebrate the 85th birthday of a true hero, my dad, Stephen Riggins. His dedication to aiding fellow veterans with PTSD has been a beacon of hope for many. Despite his recent diagnosis of Alzheimer's and vascular dementia, his spirit remains unshaken and his legacy of resilience continues to inspire many. I've received countless phone calls from veterans, other people whose lives he's touched. Many tell me how his strength and will got them through some of their darkest times. So I know him as my dad, of course, but it also fills my heart to also know him as a wonderful man who has impacted so many other people in such a remarkable way. Guys, I'm leaving this one up to you. Please give him whatever you feel is appropriate for someone who has selflessly done so much for others. And while he doesn't listen to the radio, I'm recording this and I'm going to play it for him. And I know he'll appreciate it. Thanks, guys, for all you do. That from Sam.
Please clap.
Hi, guys. Here you go.
Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday to you, to you, to you.
BG. Yaws of Dirty Germans brought to you by Men's Room Original Sausage. Available through Uli's World Famous Sausage, mensroomlive.com, and other fine retailers. Schweinefleisch.
Thank you, Mom. A couple extra emails here real quick. Interesting on the conversation we were having yesterday about professional teams that share the same name. It was one of the questions on...
Oh, it's car models, right?
This one.
All right.
This one based on the fact that out of the four pro leagues, the main ones, which teams share a common name.
Okay.
So I came to 12 teams that share the same name. The L.A. Kings and hockey. L.A. Kings and?
Sacramento.
Sacramento Kings. Arizona Cardinals and?
St. Louis.
Carolina Panthers and?
Florida.
Texas Rangers.
New York Rangers.
San Francisco Giants.
New York.
Winnipeg Jets.
New York.
There you go. That's all I could come up with. Thanks, guys. Evan, Kevin. We're going to have to re-explore that topic a little bit. I know
that opened up a can of worms.
It really did. What's the crazy name you remember? Greetings. In Phoenix, Arizona, there's a dive restaurant called Beat That Meat Barbecue. Cheers, guys. That's from Jeff in Phoenix. Couple more on that one. Guys, my favorite place name is an Irish bar in downtown Appleton that's called the Dirty Leprechaun. Also, I don't know if you remember, you had a shot of the day of a football player from Indiana who's going to WVU named Noah.
Oh, yeah.
Noah.
Yeah, you can't say it.
Let me see.
I don't know.
Nijah?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this guy made big news.
No, but I think that his name is pronounced differently than the spelling.
I think that he will tell you to pronounce it differently than the spelling.
Yeah.
It's Nijah.
Yes. Regarding food, I would not eat again the Volcano Burrito, or I would eat again, and Volcano Taco from Taco Bell. Restaurants that I wish we still had where I am, Jack in the Box and Whataburger. My family aren't much for fast food, but if I ever go to Texas, I'm going to demand that they take me to one of those. That from Paul, who says, P.S. Thrill. Stop hating on Bonnie Tyler's Total Eclipse of the Heart, one of the best songs ever written. Listen to the instrumental part with all the sound effects.
Brother, that song is awful. Yeah. Hey, look, don't worry about my... If you like it, you like it. Having bad taste, don't beat yourself up about it.
That from Paul. Okay, let's see here. I think it's time that we go back in time to the last time that we played Ted versus the FCC. So if we could, let's go back in time.
Cat cuts cups and guzzles gum. Gum guzzling cats, cups can't keep cat's coffee confined. Cat's coffee creeps from cat's cut while cat guzzles gum.
Three times fast.
Cat cuts cups and guzzles.
Wow. Oh my God. That was
quick.
That was strike two on that Ted versus the FCC.
Yep. Let's do it again.
And now, everyone's favorite daytime game show, where one person could lose $325,000 and their job, or win, and walk away with nothing. It's time for Ted versus the FCC.
Oh,
we should be.
Yeah, not because we were coming up with rhymes and riddles for Ted versus the FCC. We actually just went out and got loaded. Hell of it. No, why not?
That's two late nights for you. I saw you late on Wednesday.
Yeah. Well, I mean, same time, same channel.
Yeah.
Let's keep it
back
up.
Back down at Sluggers.
Well, you know, once Wednesday night after Rolling Stones, I figured to myself, you know, I've got the schedule done. I can be at 1:30, 2 a.m.
3 a.m.
party. What time did you get to bed on Wednesday night?
Man, it was late.
I was 3 a.m.
Yeah, because I went home. I was still all jazzed up and started watching Dark Side of the Ring.
Yeah, when you brought that up the other day, I cannot believe you went home and just started watching television. I mean, by the time I don't even think I took my shoes off. I think I woke up with, like...
Yeah,
like
just fully clothed.
Just flat on the frickin' bed. Okay, we're going to try this. As you know, three strikes and you're out. So, Ted, this is your only opportunity to get this one right. It comes from Mumbles, and it goes something like this. He says, good luck, Ted. Cat cuts cups and guzzles gum. Gum guzzling cat's cups can't keep cat's coffee confined. Cat's coffee creeps from cat's cut while cat guzzles gum. The way that we do Ted versus the FCC, you need to read that one time through, then three times fast.
All right. Let's get it one time fast.
One more time.
All right. One at a time. Let's go, buddy.
Right. We're just going to one time fast. Thanks, coach.
I'm still just
going to... Yeah,
Jesus.
Wow.
I mean, you didn't say it, but I'm still just going to be safe.
It's not my fault. This cat is a...
That's a weird cat.
All right. Cat cuts cups and guzzles gum. Gum guzzling cats. Cups can't keep cat's coffee confined. Cat's coffee creeps from cat's cut while cat guzzles gum.
Three times fast.
Cat cuts cups and guzzles gum. Gum guzzling cat's cups. Can't keep cat's coffee confined. Cat's coffee creeps from cat's cut. Well, oh, come on.
She can't get enough of it. She loves it.
I need to date this woman.
They say it's good for your hair. Gosh. Protein injection. Give me that damn thing.
We got to save this for another Men's Room World Tour.
I've said that
C word more.
That cat's going to file a lawsuit. Like, look, man, I do not do what Ted says. It's milk.
But all the cats in the neighborhood, all the strays love that cat.
That's why they're always at my back door. Right.
Coming up, we will drink and toast with a shout of the day into the weekend. You are listening to The Men's Room.
Welcome to Nada Yada Island.
This season on Nada Yada Island.
When we were new, they spoiled me. They even gave me a phone. But then, it's like I didn't exist.
Don't take yada yada from your wireless carrier. Now with Metro, get that new customer feeling again and again. Introducing Metro Flex. Free 5G phones when you join, same deals as new customers when you stay. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Just bring your number and ID and sign up for an eligible plan. After 12 months, trade in and get our best deals on select devices.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
For the ones who know safety isn't a catchphrase, it's a culture. And the ones who help make sure everyone makes it home safe. For the safety-minded who watch everyone's backs, Grainger offers supplies and solutions for every industry, as well as safety assessments and training to keep your facilities safe and your people safer. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
I've got this neighbor, Ned, who brags about having the best smart home. So, I showed him my Ecobee smart home. Turns out, Ecobee's a lot smarter, is easier to use, and saves money. Ecobee's the smartest choice I've ever made, except for my little Pomeranian.
Oh, yes. Oh, you are so cute. Aren't you my little pom-pom?
Sorry. So tell the Ned on your block about Ecobee. Just yell, get yourself a smarter home. Visit Ecobee.com today.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
All right, count up minutes. We will drink and toast in the weekend with a shot of the day. And we do have your headlines on the way at 5:50. But first, quick check out with Mike Hogg at some of the stories and headlines he is not working on.
Thank you, Miles. A new survey suggests millennials are not prepared for the, quote, great wealth transfer.
I read part of this, so the idea is that boomers are about to leave a bunch of cash.
Correct. They're about to leave them their inheritance, but millennials aren't quite ready to handle this kind of money. It's like, well, no duh.
That's a good problem to have.
Right.
People that play Powerball are not, like, prepared to win $900 million.
Exactly. Well, and at the end of the day,
you find a way to live with that problem.
Isn't it going to stimulate the economy by starting to pour that back in instead of just hoarding it all away as well? Like, isn't that how it works? I could be wrong. I'm not an economist.
Well,
but
I'd say save it, spend it, or invest it, guys. I mean, that's...
Exactly.
Kind of learn three options or light it on fire. It's up to you.
Right.
Like, hey, man, if you're going to get a bunch of cash, I don't know what to do. Best problem you will ever have in your life.
Right. Sit down and figure out what to do. Heck, you got a lot of money. Hire a financial advisor. I'm sure they could help.
Right. It's almost like that's their job.
And again, millennials are not just a bunch of, you know, deer with their deer in the headlights. They will figure things out. Okay.
Yeah, I think it's a misleading headline.
It is.
Like, you're not prepared.
My mommy's not here. I don't know what to do.
Like, right. I don't think they're unhappy.
Right.
They're just not prepared. That's okay.
Correct. Hey, here's $1 million.
It's like a surprise party. I did not know this. I was ill-prepared.
Right.
But I'm cool with this.
I'm excited. Let me figure out what to do. There's a members-only club in New York City with a gun range in the basement.
Okay.
Yeah, I saw part of that today. I'm like, damn, man, that's cool.
I mean, yeah.
Doesn't surprise me.
Could be a bowling alley. Yeah. Whatever.
Exactly.
But I mean, as long as they can keep it quiet.
Is it in Manhattan?
Noise ordinance.
Not positive. I think so, though.
Yeah. I mean, that's only odd. Is I don't think you're allowed to have a firearm in Manhattan.
Gotcha.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think you're
that's
right.
That's like a big deal. That's why, what's his name? years ago, Plexico Burris got in so much trouble because it's like, you're not even supposed to have a gun, man.
Aside from injuring yourself with the gun, you weren't supposed to have this here.
Correct.
Gotcha. I mean, I wouldn't mind that. Going to a club, there's a gun range. To me, it's kind of like the axe throwing bars.
Yeah, you're cool. Right?
Hell yeah, it's a terrible combination, alcohol and weaponry. However, it's also terribly fun.
Yeah, but the people that go there, I would imagine, are very, very responsible.
Yes.
And a lot of those old school private member clubs and stuff, like, people, I mean, I'm sure they go and drink there, but a lot of people do a lot of stuff there. That's just like their home away from home. Right. Not all bad, but I'm just that's just their home away from home.
Right. Exactly.
I mean, Miles can attest. Like, I know you're not a country club guy, but, like, people that golf that are members of country clubs, like, they're hanging out in that club a lot, whether they shot around or not.
They're going to spend their monthly food and beverage dues.
Yeah, that's what it is. That's
gotcha. Yes. So they just go up there, they have lunch, have drinks.
So you're going to spend $300, $400 a month.
Right.
Yeah, take advantage.
Yeah, might as well go and get your food. You've already paid for it.
That's a fact. And those clubhouses are nice. I've seen a handful of them. They're nice.
Yeah, Rainier's a great spot.
Yeah.
Like, just downtown.
Exactly.
If you're a member, I mean, I can't go.
Oh, one day, Miles, we'll get you in there. A new study found 67 minutes outside helps refresh your mental health.
Well, sure.
If only they told people to get outside more often.
It never comes up.
It never does.
If you work in a building, it's hard.
No kidding.
I mean, you could take a walk on your lunch break.
Right.
And you're not eating.
I mean, we're working in this building, but we have the great fortune of being able to look outside at all times.
Which is very nice.
At the sunshine that we're missing on the regular basis.
Yeah,
however,
but we also see the gloom we're missing on a regular basis, right? So trade one for the other.
And we got a hell of a canvas of the city of Seattle over here just to get that nasty rain that comes down.
Yeah,
man.
But not for the first 4 hours we're here. We're in a cubby hole with no light.
That's a fact.
In cubicle hell.
Has Dave gotten back to us about taking that doggone office?
No, all the other people just... All the other people who aren't here took all the office space with the views.
They did.
They're not here.
I mean, our boy Drew even moved over and he got another...
They just moved all of them to the nicest place and they're not here.
Yeah.
Kept us in the back of a hole.
Right.
Thanks.
Half of them work from freaking home.
Like, I know.
Leave them in our spot.
The only way they'll come to work is if they feed them free food.
Yeah.
They got to bribe them.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Scooby snacks.
Yeah. Then they don't give us any of the lunch.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And Miles, that was a phrase right there. Thanks. It was a phrase that actually sounds nice, but it was more rude than it sounded.
It was just like, thanks, seriously.
Miles, I'm setting something up here, buddy.
I know. Why can't we have breakfast?
10 phrases that sound nice, but are actually rude. There's this saccharine, sweet, genuinely decent person I know. This person says things that the pessimistic cynic in me urges me to want to clock this person in the face repeatedly. Like, great job handling that on your own. I know there's no ulterior motive behind the statement, but that doesn't mean I don't want to set them on fire. Because I do.
Handling that on your own. Thanks.
Yeah, way to handle it on your own.
What is that on your own?
Oh, Lord. So these are phrases that sound nice but are actually rude. So saying something like, you're much better looking in person. It's said in a positive, but it's not very kind. You're basically saying the person looks bad in pictures.
Well
you still never said they look good.
Is you.
So, right.
They didn't say you look good. You just look better. You're not nearly as alarming as I thought you'd be.
Yeah.
Well, you don't take pictures well, do you?
You've lost so much weight.
Yeah, I've said that before. And again, I'm not trying to be rude. It's actually meant as a compliment.
It is. Correct. Well, that's the whole thing. It sounds nice, but it's actually rude to say.
You look so much fatter, also.
Because here's the thing.
It's not.
If you put in the effort to lose weight, I don't feel like it's insulting. That was your goal. It's one thing if, like, I have an eating disorder.
I have cancer.
Right.
I'm going through chemo. Oh, my bad.
Right. You know, if you show up all of a sudden and you're, you know, you've been hitting the gym and you just look jacked, it's not rude to say, dude, you've been hitting the gym. You look good.
Don't you want people
to
know?
Right. It's not subliminally saying, boy, you were flabby about 2 years ago.
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily mean that you look like crap before. This is literally like, wow. Whatever it is you're doing, like, it's made a profound difference in your appearance.
Down.
And you're going to work on your face. See, then it gets rude.
Because you need to.
I mean, that was one thing that people told me. Boy, that beard's coming in nice. Like,
your face was ugly.
Even with one chin, you're ugly. You know, I mean,
I said that earlier to a person outside.
With one chin?
No, your beard looks great.
Oh.
I'm assuming this was a female?
Oh.
Yeah, she didn't mess with you.
I didn't say that.
Did she hear you?
You did.
No.
No, I didn't say you.
But it was
a dude.
Oh, God.
It was a dude.
Saying something like, it's not your fault you didn't know any better. Says it's all about tone, though it can be said with empathy. It's often dripping in judgment.
It's situational.
Tone matters a ton.
It really does.
Which is why
I can say that to my kids, and I mean it legitimately. Hey, look, man, you didn't know any better. Don't worry about it. That's one thing. If I'm saying it to my wife, chances are I'm being an a-hole.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
say it right. I'm thinking about me saying it to somebody, like another adult, like, well, you wouldn't know any better, you dumb piece of
shit. Yeah, that's basically what you're saying. I think you're stupid. I'm not surprised.
Kind of works in conjunction with it, but you're smart for a blank. Well, you're smart for a radio guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you do get that stuff. Yeah. Not just radio, but anything.
That's backhand.
Right.
It is.
Or from being from a place. Oh, you're smart, Mike, from being from Enumclaw.
Exactly.
You know, it's the same difference.
If you're black, you hear, oh, you're very articulate. So now it's why do you say that? And the discomfort they have, I'm like, okay. You brought it up. I'm just follow-up question.
You're amazed by it.
What was your expectation and why? Right.
Say, mama.
Another one that I'm trying to get out of the practice of is, you know, so-and-so. You know, she's actually like 92. Like, holy cow, she looks good for her age. No, she looks good.
She looks good, but look, man, I do believe there's an honesty to it.
Age questions are a trap.
They are, but also, if you're going to ask, you're going to get an answer. And look, a lot of people, and even a woman who's 7 years old, if you thought she's 55, she is happy. Same thing with a dude, right? Either way. Like, they're happy about it. This is not an insult, so you say you look good for your age. And in my mind, you understand why they're saying that. Because other people your age don't look like you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, somebody said it to me last week, or a couple weeks ago. It was a compliment, but I was joking.
But they thought you were 30.
I was joking with another coworker, another person in this building, who I know is closer to my age, but I have answered some questions for the, you know, I keep up on the kids slang. So I was like, yeah. Like, she was like, you graduated in 1999? I was like, yeah. She goes, I thought you were a lot younger. And I was like, well, thanks.
Yeah.
It does sound, it was a century ago.
Yeah, damn it.
Phrases that sound nice but are actually rude. You know what, Thrill? You're pretty when you smile.
Well, thank you, Mike. First of all, you're correct.
Right.
I'm also pretty when I don't. But no, I understand on that one.
Exactly.
Oh, that's, you should smile more. You're pretty when you smile.
Back to that one. I think that's more offensive.
Yeah.
You know,
just don't say it to women.
Smile.
Right. I'm not having a good friggin' day.
Yeah.
I don't feel like smiling.
I don't think people mean it the way that it comes out. I think what they're saying, and look, you're still going to take it poorly. And I get it. But I think what they're saying is like, your smile is infectious or it lights up the room or whatever. Right. But we never say that. It's like, oh, man.
Now, there's a lot of creepy guys that look at women and just go, you know, you'd be prettier if you smile.
Right.
There's or creepy like, guys that do that.
You're
I
like,
know.
Why don't you smile in the bar? Like, there's a lot of stuff people
be
say.
Be more appealing for me. Do you realize your resting face, you look miserable all the time?
Right.
Just say that. I mean, seriously, like, you look like you're always angry in a bad mood, even though you're not. That's amazing.
Do your friends tell you have resting bitch face?
Are you trying to keep people away? Because it's working.
Yeah, it's like, she's working a desk job, taking care of customers. Like, don't tell her to smile.
Guy, girl, doesn't matter. You look angry.
Phrases that sound nice but are actually rude. Ted, I just love that you don't care.
Yeah. All right.
I've heard that once, but the person who told me meant it, and I did not take it. Years ago, I just remember this one girl working at a restaurant. I don't remember what the situation was, and I said, man, I really don't care. And she was asking, like, do you want to do this, this, or this? And I remember she looked me dead in the eye, and she goes, the one thing I truly appreciate about you is when you say you don't care, I know you mean it. And I took it as, I'm like, yeah, I'm not effing around. I don't care.
I don't think that's that bad.
No.
Not at all.
Miles, just like you.
What's that?
It's just like you to wear a shirt like that, buddy.
It's just like Steve to wear what he wears every day.
Exactly. I am right.
I expect that.
You are wearing
I expect his shoes
man.
To be crazy. I expect his shirt to be absolutely obnoxious. but that's what I expect from Steve. I expect Steve's going to go to a wedding and look better than the bride and the groom.
I can't help when people marry ugly people.
You know, they say, like, don't show up the bride and the groom. Yeah, right. He doesn't care. He'll come in like...
Well, it's like he's showing up in a white dress.
No, he could look like Bozo
I'm
the
doing
clown.
That next.
Like, you can dress better than the groom, but yeah, just...
It's the bride, right? The groom's like, hey, man, don't outdo
that
me.
That suit is better than your wedding dress.
Steve, you've been telling me about all these hard times that you've been going through. You're so strong.
Is that an insult?
No, I don't think so at all.
It says it only brings attention to how terrible the person's life is at the moment, they say.
But okay. It seems like, but you're doing well with it. So what you're trying to say is, hey, look, I know there's a lot of stuff on your plate right now, but within this conversation, it seems like you're okay.
Legitimately, right. I think it depends who brings it up. If you have not brought anything up to me, and I said, Ted, hey, man, you're a strong character.
You're a strong man.
Ted be like, I was talking about football.
Right.
Then it's insulting. But yeah, if you just told me a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, that one seems fine, right? If somebody's being like, man, I want to like, oh, well, you know, like, good on you.
Yeah.
At least you're keeping it together. Because there's sometimes people tell you something, it's like, Jesus, I'd be a mess.
Yeah, absolutely.
Ted, trimming your beard like that, man, I like it. It makes you look so young.
Is this really, are these really bad things to say?
Because it's
implication that you look like
right.
It's like when people say, boy, if we go to a wedding and it's co-workers or something, they're, man, you guys clean up nice. I know they don't mean it as an insult, but clearly what they're saying is, you look like asshole.
Well, no, what they're saying is, I never see you dress up.
Right,
right.
In my mind, that's how I interpret it.
That's not what they mean with you, Mom.
Yeah. I know that.
I'm glad you think that.
That's how I am going to process things.
Hey, Thrill!
Positive Friday.
Glad it's the truth. Like, Thrill knew just from the picture Mike posted on Derby Day. He's like, well, they must be somewhere. Like, why is Ted in a button-up on the weekend?
You know what? You're a hunter, and it wasn't an insult.
He used to dress like crap.
There's Ted. He's looking sharp. And but I know how you are, too. And it's like, I knew you were somewhere because of the way you were dressed, man.
Thrill comes around the corner.
They're not taking pictures of Ted's shoes. That's when you know he's dressing up.
Right.
Have you ever worn those before?
Nope. How are you still single? Again, these are phrases that sound nice but are actually rude.
Because I'm smart. Because I want money for me.
I stopped saying that in my age in the early 40s.
Yeah, you get some responses.
I just wouldn't say that in general. Like, she's never been married, no kids, nothing. Like, oh, she's crazy.
Yeah.
Yes.
But I mean, she's attractive. Yeah.
Halle Berry.
Yeah, right.
But then the number one phrase that sounds nice but is actually rude. Wow. You clean up nicely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was just saying it.
I shower once a month. I'm like, yeah.
I mean, I think also, like, that one can be annoying as hell. I think there's a nice way to, like, Thrill's just saying, you just be like, oh, you look sharp tonight.
If you know that person, though, you know it's a personal dig from your
friend. Oh, yeah.
That's
oh, yeah.
the whole point.
Miles, you just love this list.
I do. All these things are perfectly acceptable to me.
A daycare owner and three of their employees have been arrested after their business practices came to light.
What were those business practices they were doing?
Tell you all about it at 5:50.
Thank you, sir. Headlines are coming up at 5:50. In the meantime, if we made it to the weekend and drinking time.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
For the ones who know safety isn't a catchphrase, it's a culture. And the ones who help make sure everyone makes it home safe. For the safety-minded who watch everyone's backs, Grainger offers supplies and solutions for every industry, as well as safety assessments and training to keep your facilities safe and your people safer. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger. For the ones who get it done.
Welcome to Nada Yada Island.
This season on Nada Yada Island.
When we were new, they spoiled me. They even gave me a phone. But then, it's like I didn't exist.
Don't take Yada Yada from your wireless carrier. Now with Metro, get that new customer feeling again and again. Introducing Metro Flex. Free 5G phones when you join, same deals as new customers when you stay. Only at Metro by T-Mobile. Just bring your number and ID and sign up for an eligible plan. After 12 months, trade in and get our best deals on select devices.
Are you ready to unleash superior seating performance on your operation? Choose from two revolutionary Great Plains drills. The BD7600 Mintil Drill, renowned for its seating consistency, large capacity, and innovative technology, including Drill Command. And the new BD7410 Drill, whose transport width under 10 feet delivers great maneuverability through gates and down narrow roadways. Each model is engineered for the proven performance you've come to expect from Great Plains.
Start your summer road trip at Midas and get up to $30 off your next repair service. Plus, get a free closer look vehicle check to make sure you're road trip ready. So if you need a brake service, an alignment check, or tune-up, hit up Midas for up to $30 off. For more details, request your appointment at Midas.com.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime. Made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Nerds. Today's episode is sponsored by NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast. Get your head in the financial game with smart investing and budgeting tips straight from the nerds. NerdWallet's experts will set future you up for success with dependable, fact-based insights. No financial misinformation allowed. Learn how to save on your summer vacation, find your next credit card or loan for a big purchase, and invest in your next index fund. Make smarter decisions in 2024. Follow NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast on your favorite podcast app.
What's up? It's your boy, the Ted Smith from the Men's Room. And did you know I have a podcast? Well, I do. The Podcast. New episodes uploaded every Wednesday on the Odyssey app.
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. Monster Keto! And the Men's Room knows just who it is. So to you, we say, bottoms up, sailor. Monster Keto! You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Drink time it is. As usual, we head to the drink desk and Steve and Thrill Hill to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. And today, thank you, Ted, we chose 45-year-old actor and singer Tyrese. Now, first, I think we can all agree that no one wants to be served papers, right? Nobody. So if you know you're going to be served, you make yourself difficult to find. For example, officials in Arizona and New York, they've been trying to track down real-life goblin Rudy Giuliani, right? They've been trying to serve him a summons to appear in court, but nobody can find his ass because he knew it was coming. So he's, right, he's just getting out of the way. And it's like this ongoing thing for a few weeks. Well, guess what? Turns out Tyrese also about to be served papers in his case regarding a $10 million lawsuit against him. Now, he happens to be on tour, so he's real easy to track down. And in this case, Tyrese, he's performing at an amphitheater in Atlanta. Now, it seems that the process server was waiting for him backstage. And you think to yourself, hey, man, what a great plan, right? He'll finish the show, we serve him the papers, and then the rest is his problem. Well, as he's performing the song, How You Gonna Act Like That, a security guard whispered something in his ear. So he's on stage singing. You don't hear the security guard. You just see him go up to his ear, says something. So Tyrese, he kept singing, and then he descended the stairs of the stage and into the crowd, and the crowd's kind of excited at first, and then he kept singing, and he made his way up the walkway. Just picture, like, White River Amphitheater. He kept singing, and he gets to that point where you're leaving the chairs and you're going to the lawn, and he kept singing, and he kept singing, and he kept walking, and then he stopped singing, and he was gone. Apparently, the security guard let him know, hey, man, they're about to serve you papers backstage. Tyrese in the middle of a concert.
I mean, he's at it. So picture White River. Imagine the singer gets off the stage, right? Which people
still,
do.
Sure. Still singing. Right, still the crowd. Singing.
And he just walked up the right side and then was gone.
Oh, yeah, but he sang the whole time until they got to the point where you get to the lawn. Picturing White River, right? The point you get to
Gavin
the lawn.
Gavin Rossdale went up to the crowd.
And then he's kind of like, all right, guys, thank you. Good night. Disappeared, man. They can't find us. Oh, yeah. So security guard let him know.
$10 million. Hey, man. He knows somebody.
Yeah, there's a lawsuit against them about whatever, you know, just typical stuff. But they're trying to serve his ass papers. Security guard let him know. Tyrese literally in the middle of his concert just kept walking into the crowd, to his credit, kept singing, got to the lawn. Out.
Innocent.
Yeah. It's like, damn, man. That's one way to avoid it. So we pour this booze and we drink this booze because we think it's yummy.
Yummy.
So over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies.
Down the hola, bitola.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
It's Bad Choice Friday.
You know it's Bad Choice Friday.
This is your fault.
FYI, Armed Forces Day is tomorrow. We celebrate today on a Bad Choice Friday. The choice is the Village People in the Navy and the Gap Band, and you dropped a bomb on me. Mike, how was the voting?
It was a decently close poll there, Miles, with a 43-57 split. We do love all branches of the military, and it is not just about the Navy today. That's why we are dropping the bomb on this Bad Choice Friday.
Here we go. We go back to the junior high dances today.
Oh, yeah. Weddings. High school, weddings.
Ow. Welcome to the weekend. You are listening to The Men's Room, 99.9 KISW Seattle.
With an American Standard heat pump system, the future of heating and cooling your home is already here. Bringing constant comfort to your home, American Standard heat pumps are energy efficient, reliable, and ready for tomorrow, today. Plus, making the upgrade from your traditional furnace or AC unit is easier than ever before with home energy offers, rebates, and tax credits. Learn more at AmericanStandardAir.com/electrification. American Standard. Built to a higher standard.
Are you a fan of mystery and adventure? Introducing June's Journey, the captivating free-to-play mobile game that will ignite your inner detective. Play as June Parker in a thrilling murder mystery adventure as you search for hidden objects to uncover the truth behind her sister's death. Step into the glamorous world of the Roaring Twenties with stunningly illustrated scenes and over 1,000 mysteries to unravel. With new chapters added weekly, you'll never run out of clues to chase and suspects to interrogate. Plus, you can build your own island escape with beautiful gardens and buildings and even join a detective club to collaborate with other players. Experience the thrill of being a detective and unravel the mystery in June's Journey. Download June's Journey now on your Android or iOS device or play on PC through Facebook Games.
Want a natural way to reduce fine lines and wrinkles? Dermaclear has got you. Our 100% medical-grade silicone face patches are meticulously formulated for visible improvements in as little as 20 minutes and lasting results in 30 days or get your money back, guaranteed. They're safe and reusable and enhance your skin's natural healing process. Embrace the future of skincare and join countless satisfied customers who've transformed their skin with Dermaclear. Visit Dermaclear.com today and say goodbye to wrinkles and hello to beautiful, healthy skin.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Now for all TV news all the time, and it's time for TV Time with Ted.
And now, because your pathetic life is confined to countless hours in front of a talking box, the men's room presents TV Time with Ted.
Ah! All right, your choices today. You got Seth Meyers, Stephen Colbert, the Jimmys,
Kimmel and Fallon, or Ted Smith.
Is it Ted or is it late night?
It is right there. The title of this guy's have teams of talents and writers hoping to come up with their monologues each and every night. It is up to you to determine, is this an actual late night joke and from whom, or could it be a The Ted Smith original?
Uber announced they will now have Uber Shuttle, which allows users to reserve a vehicle to one destination, like an airport or a concert. These guys are amazing. First they invent the taxi, and now they invent the bus.
Colbert.
The Ted Smith.
Myers.
Uber announced they will offer Uber Shuttle, which allows users to reserve seats in a vehicle heading to one destination, like an airport or concert. Those guys are amazing. First they invent the taxi, and now they invent the bus.
Lego announced the new 5,000-piece Lord of the Rings set that costs $460. Anyway, if you're looking for a line to end a first date, that should do it.
The Ted Smith.
Stephen Colbert.
Fallon.
Well, listen to this. Lego just announced a new 5,000-piece Lord of the Rings fortress set that costs $460. Anyway, if you're looking for a line to end a first date, that ought to do it.
A raccoon got lost and got loose and entered the field of play during a Philadelphia Union soccer match last night. No one is sure how the raccoon got there, but since it's Philly, the trash panda is most likely related to a fan in the stands.
Ted Smith.
Ted Smith.
Yeah, take that, Philly. People gross. Nasty. The NFL has announced that they will have a Black Friday game for a second year in a row. It's the only Black Friday event that causes more concussions than Walmart.
Fallon?
Seth Meyers.
The NFL has announced they will have a Black Friday game for the second year in a row. It's the only Black Friday event that causes more concussions than Walmart.
Come on, NFL. I love you.
You can steal Christmas from the NBA, but don't be taking Black Friday from college football.
Well, it's kind of, well, that's right, college football, okay.
There's some massive games. Generally, like the Apple Cup, not anymore.
Are they not going to do the Apple Cup?
They are, but it's in September, whereas traditionally you would play those rivalry games.
Rivalry week, yeah.
Right, you know, any of them, right? You know, Michigan, Ohio State play the last weekend, South Carolina, Clemson, any of those ones. So traditionally, Alabama, Auburn, I always thought that Friday was great for football just because of that. I'll tell you what, a couple years ago, man, the fact there was a U.S. Soccer World Cup game at like 11, and then there was college football on all day on that Friday, I was like, this is the greatest Friday maybe ever.
I'm not shopping.
Well, plus on Black Friday, man, you got all those leftovers. For whatever reason, I feel like that Saturday, there's always something going on. That Sunday, there'll be football on. But I feel like that Friday is a little looser. You can kind of, I don't know.
It is a looser day.
Correct, right? Because the day before is such a massive holiday. And then I feel like Saturday, you kind of get family or friends back together. But like that Friday, it's like, let's just hang out, watch some games.
Yeah.
All right, it's been more than 10 years since The Office went off the air. John Krasinski has finally admitted what he stole from the set. Until now, John's always lied to the guy that created the series, Greg Daniels, about taking a sign, but obviously now it's real. He was on the podcast with Jenna Fischer and Angela Kingsley, Office Ladies, where he revealed that he walked off with the Dunler Mifflin sign.
Nice.
Angela actually saw him stuff with the sign in the back of his car. And called it, quote, one of my favorite memories. John said, I was like, don't look over here. It was quite dark enough. It wasn't quite dark enough. So, yeah, I just looked like I was putting a body in my car.
It's funny when if you read through what celebrities stole from the set. Like, I want to say, Chris Hemsworth, they told him not to. He took his Thor hammer. He's like, look, dude, I've done all these Avenger movies. I want the hammer. We can't have it. He took it any damn way. I'm sure they have a few more. He took it. I want to say... Daniel Radcliffe from all of his years doing with Harry Potter. I can't remember what it was, but something fairly significant. Same thing.
I think like a pair of glasses or something like that.
Well, man, you can't have those. And he's like, yeah, yeah, cool. He's like, yeah, I took them. Like, what are they going to do? A couple of people from Game of Thrones, because the costumes and all the weaponry and all, it's such a massive thing. A couple of people are like, look, the only thing we couldn't take was the Iron Throne. Like, they had that thing on lockdown, but a couple of the costumes, a couple of my fake swords, like, yeah, I took them.
Well,
and what are you going to do?
I also press on it with a show that ran for as long as The Office. Like, of course he's going to take something.
You're attached to it.
Could you guys imagine doing this show for as long as we have, and then all of a sudden, you know, it comes to an end amicably or not, whatever, and then you just walk away and you have nothing really to show for it?
Oh, I'm stealing crap from here. I already stole our old mic flags, you know. So like, when you watch a press conference and you'll see, like, you know, I don't know, Como 4 on the mic. So that's the mic flag. Yeah, I took one that says KISW.
I have one for every station I've ever worked for.
And they're completely
stolen. I'm going to steal a green bean shirt.
If they had them, no, you won't, because you don't have one.
Because we can't find
one. So I got to steal one.
Yeah. I'm going to steal the board. Taking the whole board with us.
Well,
man.
I think the other difference is, though, a little bit different. It's like TV shows, though, like when it ends, that's it.
Yeah.
Whereas,
you're not
like,
using
when we're, right, you know, when we're out of here, like somebody else is going to be in here doing a show.
Right. They're just not going to have mic flags.
Right. Well, makes it a little bit tougher, right?
Don't even know what station they're on.
And I can also understand with, like, I don't understand with the movies. Thor's hammer. What else are you going to use that for?
No, dude, if I'm Thor, if I'm what people recognize to be Thor,
right.
I want the hammer.
Exactly.
For me.
Even the costumes. Oh, we'll use that for the next movie. You update it for the next movie anyway.
Chris Pratt, I know he took his jacket from the Guardians of the Galaxy thing.
The red leather one.
And again, they told him, like, hey, man, don't take that. But he's like, no, I'm taking it. Right. I am the freaking character. And by the way, you paid me enough. I'll just pay for it. If it's a problem, I'll write a check.
Yeah, I mean, I imagine the guy that created this series, like, I could imagine he's probably the only person other than, like,
the
Krasinski that could be like, don't take the damn sign, man. Like, I created the series. But, yeah, for the most part, I'm with you with the actors. It's like, all right. Whoever directed Thor didn't invent the character Thor.
You did not invent the character, and now this is the guy that brought it to life, whether you like it or not. And that's the thing, if you're the actor that really brought a certain character to life, and that character somehow survives pop culture, right? It's not going to be forgotten. I absolutely am stealing a memento. Like, I can't take the Batmobile. I understand.
Yeah, but Jason Momoa took a dolphin from Aquaman.
But, like, I'm keeping my Batman outfit, one of them. If I worked on Lassie, I'm taking the dog.
It's mine.
She's mine now.
It's well-trained.
We've been working with each other for years.
Yeah, the costumes for sure. I mean, there's some people that hate them, right? Like, Michelle Pfeiffer is pretty famous for, like, when she was Catwoman.
Sure, I get it.
She was like, I hated wearing that thing. Like, I never want to be in it again.
But even if you steal it, you're not, the guy that played C-3PO, Anthony Daniels, they said during the Star Wars Empire Strikes Back, the thing was so constricting and uncomfortable. He lost his mind one time on set and stabbed this thing to pieces with scissors.
Oh, no kid.
Yeah, I mean, and I get it. Like, he's like, I understand it's an iconic character. I get all that. But he's like, to wear this thing 18 hours a day, you can't move, it sucks, it's hot. So he lost his mind, but he also stole one. He's like, I don't need to put it on, but that's me. I am C3 freaking PO.
Yeah, it's like having one of those like coats or armor things, and it's like it looks like the guy's in it, but it's just a
right,
you know what I mean? It's just there. And there is some awesome, cool stuff. I mean, hell, people spend. I mean, I know people that have collections of memorabilia that, I mean, they spend, whether it's sports or movies or TV shows, spend thousands of dollars
on. I'm telling you, if I'm Harrison Ford, I've taken my Han Solo vest, I've taken my Indiana Jones hat. Yes. I may or may not wear them ever again.
I think they did.
But, yeah, absolutely.
All the Friends people took something.
Yeah, I did hear that. Everybody Friends was pretty thorough about dismantling that.
What do you want? Actually, they went around. What do you want? You get first pick of whatever.
I want Jennifer Aniston.
Yeah, right. I take the foosball table from Chandler and Joey's house.
One of the two of them did take that.
All right.
I can't remember which one. Yeah, one. It may have been Joe. What's his name? Matt LeBlanc.
Well, and like, look, like we're saying, people love memorabilia or anything else, right? Like Cheers was shot on a studio, like on a set in L.A.
Mm-hmm.
But there is the actual Cheers bar in Boston. Like, you could go down the stairs. I think, like, the door looks exactly the same. So, like, you're not where they filmed it, but, like,
it's still something
about
it.
If you're in Boston, you'd still pop in there.
By the way, Ted, we got an update.
What's up?
Why are you guys talking about leaving? You're never leaving. Okay, so we're just here, though.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah, I did not know that. We're here for the long haul.
You guys know Chris Pine?
Yes.
Do you guys remember the show The O.C.?
Yeah,
I remember.
I never
watched
it.
Came out in the early 2000s, right? It was a big show. Well, he was supposed to be on there, but he lost out because he had acne.
Oh, no.
Damn, really?
Yeah. Kids in California,
they don't get acne.
No acne, kid. I don't know if you knew that.
Yeah.
It doesn't fit the role. You know?
I mean, look, I had a lot of things wrong with me as a teenager, but like acne was never one of them.
Yeah, I mean, I got pimples, but never had acne. Much different thing.
Yeah, and I know some people. I mean, it was debilitating. It's awful.
That'd take, what was the medication back then? Tetracycline, maybe?
Is that what it was?
I believe so.
I remember all the topical crap, like Stridex and all that. But right, but there's always a kid who's like, no, mine's medical grade.
Correct. I had a friend that was like that. I mean, he had to take it until, I mean, a lot of his adult life, too.
Damn.
Because it would just be awful.
Yeah, sucks, and typically, it seemed in my day, based on where I was, redheads were more affected.
Redheads seem more affected.
Skin-wise.
Right. If it has to do with skin, like, I feel for a redhead. I burn. I get acne.
Not necessarily women.
If you look at me wrong, I mean, everything.
But redheaded guys.
Yeah.
They seem to really, like, on the back of the neck and just... It just broke out on him. Because, you know, you're sitting behind him in class. You're looking, going like, I just wish I could reach you up and pop this thing.
Yeah, a couple of
Chris Pine does that, too. He's like, look, this was devastating when I was that age or whatever. But he's like, it kind of taught me a lesson, came out on the other side better. So I'm like, all right, sure. I respect that.
You know who his father was.
Chris Pine's father?
Mm-hmm.
Lieutenant America.
You and your brother used to watch this show, and on occasion.
Larry Wilcox?
He was their boss, whatever the... So you had two
chips.
Two guys who rode the motorcycles, whoever they answered to, whatever his position was. That is Chris Pine's dad, Robert Pine.
No kidding. A famous Hollywood actor's got a famous Hollywood son.
Can you believe that? So it's devastating when you don't get that role.
You always wonder how you get in.
Yeah.
Now we know.
Nepotism, baby.
All right, let's see. I hear what you're saying, Miles. What are you watching this weekend?
What are you watching this weekend, Ted?
Well,
you got
some stuff. You still, by the way, not sure how I feel about the playoffs, but Minnesota tied up that series, so it's 3-3. Still got $20 on the line that I bet at casino.
Who's bet for it?
You are, Ted.
I took the Timberwolves to win that series.
Okay.
Well, so, you're still with confidence when you originally said it.
Because, man, they got blown out the game before.
They got their butts whooped.
Yeah.
And then, right, last night, they beat them by, like, 45
points.
They're
also playing the defending NBA champions. So it's not a joke. It's not a walk.
I was going to say, so you got some games on. I want to say there is, that game is coming up this weekend. I think there's a game seven or game six tonight with Knicks and Pacers. There's a few good games.
Those guys have been chipped.
I know. They have. Well, anytime you play somebody seven games. Right. Edmonton and Toronto are still going at it over in the hockey playoffs. You got a couple other ones going on. So you got all that stuff happening. You got a brand new Saturday Night Live, which will be the season finale.
Who's hosting? Do you know?
Jake Gyllenhaal.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gillen or Gyllenhaal? Do we know?
Is it Gyllenhaal or Gyllenhaal?
I think it's
Gyllenhaal.
Right.
Gyllenhaal?
Gyllenhaal.
Gyllenhaal?
That's how you say it, man?
Gyllenhaal? Yeah.
You should do an interview with him just to harass him about it.
Hello, Jake Gyllenhaal.
Well, is your sister Maggie Gyllenhaal or is she also Gyllenhaal?
We're also getting that time of year. Just talked about Saturday Night Live. If there's a show you like that airs on Sunday night, good chance it's the season finale.
I'd say watch it.
So you might want to watch that. Your Mariners are in Baltimore. Yeah, enjoy the weekend.
Thank you, Tab. We appreciate it. You're listening to Men's Room.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime, made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Start your summer road trip at Midas and get up to $30 off your next repair service. Plus, get a free closer look vehicle check to make sure you're road trip ready. So if you need a brake service, an alignment check, or tune-up, hit up Midas for up to $30 off. For more details, request your appointment at Midas.com.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Whether you love true crime or comedy, celebrity interviews or news, you call the shots on what's in your podcast queue. And guess what? Now you can call them on your auto insurance too with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive. It works just the way it sounds. You tell Progressive how much you want to pay for car insurance, and they'll show you coverage options that fit your budget. Get your quote today at Progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill. Now, let's see what's happening in the real world.
All right, here we go. A West Virginia politician is having a hard time proving that politicians aren't snakes. Meanwhile, a man breaks into a police impound lot and guns and drugs he takes. Pro golfer makes a sea time after being released from jail. And one New Hampshire daycare man, those kids sure do sleep well. And a man breaks a world record for the longest streak of not getting leg. Oh, dude. Time for headlines.
Now, it's time to hit the head. Lines. Here's Mike Hawk.
And our top story. Wild story out of New Hampshire. A daycare owner and three of their employees have been arrested after their business practices came to light. The story doesn't detail how it was discovered, but they had apparently been sprinkling melatonin on the kids' food. While this over-the-counter drug is widely used for adults to help them sleep, it's not intended for children due to it not being regulated. And 7% of ER visits are from children who accidentally ingested and need medical attention. The daycare crew are facing some serious charges and will likely get themselves
shut
down.
Were they using the regular ones or the kid ones?
Not positive, Ted. I would hope that they're using the kid ones.
All right.
But
we don't know.
You don't know.
And I have been at somebody's home and watched a couple kids ask for a gummy. But I didn't think anything of it. And this woman goes, "Don't judge me." And I was like, "She's a nurse." And I was like, I have no idea what's going on. She was like, "They're like super low dose little kid melatonin." So I was like, "All right."
I mean, they sell it.
Yeah, I'm like, it's your kid's like,
right.
It's just one of those things. Don't judge me. I'm like, I have no idea. Doesn't seem odd to me your kid had a little gummy before bed.
Exactly. You just put your kid down is all.
Yeah. Oh, put him to sleep.
Hey, that's even better, too.
Without the chokehold.
Let's not say putting him down.
But they were also saying that this wasn't even a licensed daycare, which all they right. don't have to be in the area, but it should.
If you're going
to
do medication, you probably should.
It's a little telling, yeah. In other news, we go to Pennsylvania where a man went to great lengths to get his goods back. Police got a call about a suspicious individual that was littering, causing battery acid to flow into a sewer drain, and firing a weapon into a nearby river that is frequented by fishermen and kayakers. They arrived to find our man and took him into custody, eventually seizing his truck, where they found a good amount of drugs, paraphernalia, and illegally possessed firearm.
Did you read the list of crap they found?
Oh, dude, it was a long
good
list.
Lord,
and then
man.
Didn't they find a scale that had like ice written on it or something like that?
He had a scale and he labeled it ice.
Right.
Jesus.
They're just like, look, man, we already know what this is. Don't make it so obvious.
Yeah, like even lying, just be like food.
Right. Anything. Right?
My food
plausible
scale.
Deniability. My man wrote ice. It's like, Jesus.
I mean, that's mostly what it is foods, little those little food scales so you can measure out.
Oh, gosh.
You're trying to be very particular about what you're eating.
Right.
But that's not why people buy them. And everyone knows that. But still, don't write ice.
Also, does it need to be differentiated? Like, this scale is specifically for the meth.
Maybe he doesn't want cross-contamination, depending
correct
on the drug you're doing.
Yeah.
Because remember, gotcha, they also found fentanyl on this dude.
Sure.
So,
isn't it in a container? Are they really just pouring it right onto whatever, right onto the scale?
Well, if I have to weigh, well, yeah, either you got to calibrate it based on the weight of the container.
Sure.
Otherwise, I would just dump my drug, this is what I've heard,
well,
on the scale, right? And get my measurement, but still, I would not. So I would understand if you label it because you don't want to contaminate whatever other drugs sure he had with the fentanyl.
But at that point, residue, you might be leaving some behind. Like, recalibrate it. Like, doggone it, man. Don't be that lazy.
Yeah, I also wouldn't mess with fentanyl, is my main thing.
Yeah.
That's number one.
Anyhow, a few days later, a break-in occurred at the impound lot, and they found that our man had broken in to get his drugs out of the truck. He now faces even more charges.
I'm going to need those back.
Right.
Do you think they left them in the truck?
Exactly.
They took everything out. All your guns, all your weapons.
I like how they're arresting him. They're putting him in handcuffs. Hey, can we search your truck? No, you ain't going to search my truck.
We're going to impound it. Okay.
They impounded it and then searched the truck.
That's
dude,
exactly.
They're going to get in there. To Boone County, West Virginia.
Uh-oh.
Where the hits just keep coming for a losing candidate. Doug Scaff, former minority leader in the West Virginia House of Delegates, has been running his campaign for Secretary of State, but unfortunately did not secure the victory in the election. Being a good sport and doing the right thing, he was going around where he knew his campaign signs were still posted around the area to take them down. But on approach of one of his signs, his bad day took a turn for the worse as a copperhead reached out and bit him on the leg, sending him to the hospital.
Two of them.
He's been in recovery, but will remain in the hospital for the next few days to ensure that he's healed.
Yeah, it's by where my mom lives. One baby got him on the toe. The other mom got him on the calf.
And the babies are terrible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they don't know how to regulate
the venom. He said he could feel
the
venom. He could watch it going up his legs.
God.
And the pain was the worst pain he said he's ever had in his life.
Right. It's a fire on the inside.
Oh, it my is. God. And the good news is he had his kid with him.
7-year-old kid, yeah.
So if his kid would have got bit, I mean, that'd have been worse.
Yeah,
no kidding,
sure,
man. No kidding. And just in case those stories left a bad taste in your mouth,
thankfully, there's good news.
Up to Canada, where a record has been broken.
All right.
A Lego enthusiast has just broken a record after assembling a 75,192-piece Lego build of a Star Wars Millennium Falcon in a short 7 hours, 36 minutes, and 35
damn
seconds.
Getting late now.
What is what would you say is the average time? I don't know that world of massive Legos.
Right, neither
is
do
that
I.
A is that a, like a 20-hour project?
75,000 pieces, and it's not like any of them are all that huge.
But
so
still,
it's 7.5 hours is probably a very good
you
time.
You want to talk about paying attention to directions.
Yeah,
Legos probably got that on lock.
And like what's the parameters of that? Like, does the timer start when he opens the box, or can he lay out his pieces and like know that, okay, I'm gonna start over here and just kinda go down and just
it's a good question,
you know?
Right. I'm sure he had a
he's
system.
He's obviously put this thing together numerous times to be able to break the
maybe
record.
Dude. I don't know. But it doesn't detail what the previous record was for assembling a 75,192-piece Millennium Falcon, but we will just take their word for it that he actually did get
that's a good point.
There.
We don't know that you're telling the truth, but we'll choose to believe you.
Men's Room IPA continues to spread about the Pacific Northwest. Houndstooth Public House is where you can find it on tap, as well as Daffodil Bowl down there in Puyallup. Miles Daffodil.
Daffodil.
Yeah.
All right.
A lot of great memories down there, as well as the Twin Dragon out there in Duval. If you guys want to go and find the Men's
Twin
Room
Dragon
IPA on tap. Yes, sir. And you can find a comprehensive list of locations on the men's room page of KISW.com and just look for that bright yellow can.
And even if you don't drink, take your drinking friends to the bar that sells it.
Indeed.
There you go.
Drive them home.
Men's Room Sports, as Ted said, the Timberwolves got it done last night and pushed the Nuggets to a Game 7. That'll take place on Sunday. Tonight, you got Game 6 between the Knicks and Pacers. New York leads the series 3-2. That's on ESPN. Tomorrow, Game 6 between the Thunder and Mavericks. Dallas leading that series 3-2, and that'll be on ABC. Monster comeback for the New York Rangers last night to push out the Carolina Hurricanes in the NHL playoffs. Did you guys see that?
No.
Like 3 minutes left.
Oh, yeah. Rangers just came storming back.
And they were down 3-5-2.
Did you see the little kid? Crying in the stands?
Yes.
Oh, he was just losing it.
Like, Carolina had him dead to rights, and they hit it.
Carolina fans just losing it.
Tonight, you got a couple games. Sixes on TNT. The Panthers and Bruins are on now, and the Stars and Avalanche will play later on tonight. Florida and Dallas currently leading their respective series. Game 6 between Vancouver and Edmonton, with the Canucks leading the series, is tomorrow on ESPN at 5. Meanwhile,
come on,
your
Edmonton.
Seattle Mariners are underway in Baltimore against the Orioles, with Bryce Miller on the mound to start. And the good guys are losing.
No, we're winning. Orioles are winning.
Tomorrow's game is going to be on at 1 o'clock, Luis Castillo. And then the 10 a.m. start on Sunday with George Kirby. Those games on Root Sports. And honorable mention, your Seattle Seawolves won't be able to watch them on TV, but they're going to be in action in Dallas this weekend.
All right, boys.
Take on the Jackals this Saturday as the season's winding down, man, looking in that playoffs. As far as your weather, clouds are moving in tonight with a low of 48 before we move into a rather dark and nasty Saturday with steady rain and a high of 55. Sunday. Cool. Things are going to be clearing up a bit with partly cloudy skies and a high of 65. Enjoy that, guys.
Nice.
And that is it for your headlines. With that, have a great weekend. Mike Hawk is out.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate it. Grab a tub of salsa, an IPA, or a men's room beer, brat. We'll see you on Monday.
Yes, indeed. It's all true. But in the meantime, well, we be all about this bitch. So until next time, please do what you do best. And for Aletha's sake, stay beautiful.
The men's room has been taped before a live studio audience. Wardrobe and makeup provided by Mantastic Limited. This has been a presentation of the Men's Room Radio Network.
Oh, man!
A Double Flush production.
Start your summer road trip at Midas and get up to $30 off your next repair service. Plus, get a free closer look vehicle check to make sure you're road trip ready. So if you need brake service and alignment check or tune-up, hit up Midas for up to $30 off. For more details, request your appointment at Midas.com.
For those in the market for flavor, there's Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas, a flavorful drink that's a modern twist on a Mexican street classic with four vibrant and refreshing flavors. Pineapple, watermelon, hibiscus, and cucumber lime. Made with a splash of real fruit juice. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas are perfect for any fiesta, small or big. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas. Boldly authentic, vibrantly flavorful. Drink responsibly. Modelo Spiked Aguas Frescas flavored beers imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois. Hibiscus contains juice only for color.
Nerds. Today's episode is sponsored by NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast. Ready to expand your financial game? NerdWallet can coach you on smart strategies like choosing investments, finding your next credit card, and setting a budget that works for you. Score major points towards your summer vacation by learning expert tips for choosing a high-yield savings account and how to build wealth by investing in index funds. Slide into summer with smarter decisions in 2024. Follow NerdWallet's Smart Money Podcast on your favorite podcast app. Future you will thank you.